Welcome to the New Year's edition of Airchecks. Today and tomorrow's episodes will be dedicated to New Year's programming. Starting on January 6th, we will be cutting down to one three-hour episode. In 1950, the advent of television was not only causing concern in the film industry, but radio was beginning to feel the effect as well. In short, audiences were dwindling. To combat the problem, NBC spent lots of money to produce The Big Show, a 90-minute radio program which would feature famous guests performing skits, songs, and comedic routines. Tallulah Bankhead was asked to host the show. She had guested in various radio programs in the past but had never done anything on an ongoing basis before. She was nervous and didn't really know what to expect or what her duty actually was, so she approached the show with guarded anticipation. The Big Show premiered on November 5, 1950 and played every Sunday night for the next 3 years. It was a rousing success and Tallulah was a great success. The guest list varied but included such names as Ethel Merman, Danny Thomas, Fanny Brice, Phil Silvers, Bob Hope, Clifton Webb, Gloria Swanson, Marlene Dietrich, Judy Holliday, Ethel Barrymore, Jimmy Durante, Milton Berle, Josephine Baker, Laurence Olivier, Vivian Leigh, George Sanders, Yul Brynner, Shirley Booth, Peggy Lee, Rosalind Russell, and Merv Griffin. Here is The Big Show as broadcasted on NBC on December 31, 1950.
You're about to be entertained by some of the biggest names in show business. For the next hour and 30 minutes, this program will present in person such bright stars as
Vivian Blaine,
Jose Ferrer, Sam Levine, Ken Murray,
Margaret O'Brien,
Gloria Swanson,
Fran Warren,
Meredith Wilson,
and my name, darling, is Tallulah Bankhead.
The National Broadcasting Company presents The Big Show. The Big Show, 90 minutes with the most scintillating personalities in the entertainment world. Brought to you this Sunday and every Sunday at the same time as the Sunday feature of NBC's All-Star Festival. And here is your hostess, the glamorous, unpredictable Tallulah Bankhead.
Well, darling, how did Santa Claus treat you? I must tell you about one beautiful present I received. A new mink coat. My best friend sent it to me. I bought it myself. I saw it in the window. I liked it. I decided I simply must have it. I wrote out a check for $10,000 and took the coat with me. When I got home, I decided I'd been a little too extravagant, and so I sent it back. And what an odd coincidence. The coat got back to the store just as my check came back from the bank. But Christmas is behind us now, and we have a show to do. Last week, on our Christmas program, one of our guest stars was Margaret O'Brien of the movie. She did so well, too well to suit me, that she's with us again this week, a sort of Christmas hangover for me. I wish I could take an Aniston and make her disappear. But she's been held over by popular demand. Not mine, you understand. The child is too talented, much too talented. After all, a job is a job.
I'm not trying to take your job, Miss Bankhead.
Well, darling, little Margaret O'Brien.
I want to thank you, Miss Bankhead, for your lovely Christmas present.
Oh, did you like it, darling?
Oh, yes. It was sweet of you to send me a one-way railroad ticket to California.
I thought I wrapped it nicely.
Oh, it was super.
It was what, dear?
It was super.
A chief, of course.
But I'm not going back to California, Miss Bankhead.
You're not?
I'm going to stick right close to you.
You are not.
Because I've decided I want to be a great actress just like you are.
Oh, darling, isn't he sweet?
There's so much I can learn from you, Miss Bankhead.
Oh, Margaret, you may call me Tallulah.
Oh, may I? Thank you.
So you want to be an actress, little Margaret?
Yes, I do, big Tallulah. You see, I think a person should have an ambition, a goal in life. For 13 years now, I've been drifting aimlessly. Of course, for the last 7 years, I made a niche for myself in the movies.
Yes, a 7-year niche. And what did you do the first 6 years of your life? You're just a bum, I suppose.
Yes, those were bad years. I was disorganized, confused, tortured. I couldn't decide whether I should be in the theater or the movies. Well, I became so nervous I was eating 2 packs of chocolate cigarettes a day.
Yes, I see you still have the chocolate stains on your index finger. And I'll bet you used to hit that pablum bottle pretty hard, too.
But now I know that the theater is my real love. And you're the one I want to pattern myself after.
Oh, isn't he sweet?
To be an actress like you, acclaimed by the critics, applauded by the public, a magnetic, dynamic, electric personality. So lit up.
Watch your language, child.
I mean, the way you walk out on the stage without any assistance. That's acting, Miss Tallulah.
That black coffee, child.
That's my ambition, to be a big star like you are. And then, after I've had my success, and if I had to retire and wind up on radio like you did, well, those are the chances a person has to take.
Darling, how would you like a shot in the head? Besides, Margaret, actresses never retire. They are always between plays.
Between plays?
Yes, remember that. And besides, Margaret, I must warn you, the theater is an exacting taskmaster. To become a fine actress, it will take you years.
Oh, I don't care. I want to become a fine actress like you. Even it takes me years and years and years and years
now,
and
years. Now, just a minute, just a minute. I wonder where this child is getting her material. Margaret, here's lesson number 2. An actress is very sensitive about her age. But then I wouldn't expect you to understand that at the tender age of 13.
12 and a half. I want to be just as sensitive as you are.
Oh, Margaret, you're just a child. Now, why are we standing here talking about the theater? Such grown-up talk for a little girl. Now, let's talk about the holiday season. Now, let me tell you all about New Year's Eve.
No, don't tell me all about New Year's Eve. Why don't you just tell me all about Eve?
So that's where she's been getting her material. Well, I'll put a stop to this. Meredith! Meredith Wilson!
Yes, Miss Bankhead. I want to thank you, Margaret, for that Christmas present.
You're welcome.
Of course, I have no plans to go to California right away.
What?
Margaret sent me a one-way ticket to California, and it was very nicely wrapped, too. By the way, Miss Bankhead, thank you for your present. It was just what I needed, a box of Fragile.
Meredith, that was a 5-piece set of cut gloves.
It was more pieces than that when I got it.
And, well, I want to thank you, Meredith, for that darling scarf you sent me and that delightfully warm Christmas card you enclosed. 60% rayon, 40% wool. How warm can you get? Well, now, darling, how about some music, Meredith?
Well, sir, Miss Bankhead. This is the big week in football. The bowl games, you know. So I wrote a song for my home state university, Iowa.
Oh, is Iowa in one of the bowl games?
Well, not exactly. They might have had a chance, though. See, Iowa was just nosed out in a game with Ohio State. 83-21.
That's quite a nose.
Well, Iowa just couldn't get going in that game. Every time we started setting up a play, somebody fumbled the ball and we couldn't get to our next play. Always got caught between plays.
I'm between plays too, Meredith.
What?
Never mind, Meredith. Let's hear the Iowa fight song you wrote for Iowa, but which is dedicated to all the teams who didn't get into any of the bowl games tomorrow, but who are going to, by golly, make it next year or bust.
Thank you. Meredith, that was really swell. You've got quite a band there.
Ken Murray.
Hello, Tallulah. Tallulah, I was just listening to that Iowa fight song that Wilson wrote. Kind of brings back old memories to me.
Oh, really, darling? You went to college in Iowa, too?
Oh, no, no. As a matter of fact, I didn't go to college at all. I don't believe a man has to go to college to get an education and acquire a polish. I'm proud to say that I learned all I know in the school of H.N.
School of H.N.?
Hard knocks.
Well, it wouldn't have hurt you to have had a short spell in college, dear.
Oh, no, not me, Tallulah. You see, I started in show business when I was a kid. Never had a chance to go to school, but I used to read books all the time. Right now, I've settled down here in New York, and I've got Dr. Elliott's 5-foot bookshelf in my home.
But do you read the books in the 5-foot bookshelf?
Oh, sure. I read about 3 inches every night.
My, you read quick.
Yeah, I read that, too. We all read in my family. I read, my dog reads, even my wife, and even my dog reads.
A dog reads?
Yes, yes. For Christmas, I got him a copy of Bulldog Drummond. Of course, he's just starting to read books now. When he was a puppy, we broke him in on newspapers. But, Tallulah, I came over here to your program for a very special reason. I'm not here to be entertaining.
What makes you think you have been, darling?
I do a television program. How would you like to be a guest on my TV show?
I would rather die.
What makes you think you won't, Dolly?
Now, look here, crude cut. I'm quite satisfied to be doing the show I'm doing here.
But, Tallulah, radio is old hat.
But, Ken, television is old movies.
Not on my show. I'd certainly like to have you on my television show with me, though.
Oh, stop talking about it, darling. Whenever anyone mentions television to me, I see red.
I'll pay you $5,000.
All of a sudden, I see green. Tell me more about it, darling.
Well, there are a few things you'll have to change. For instance, if you wanted to wear a black dress like you're wearing now, you'd have to wear a red dress, because you see, red photographs black, you see?
Oh, I have a red dress. But what about my hair, darling?
I'd wear that, too. Oh, I'm sorry. You mean the color of your hair. I'm so sorry. Well, we had a girl on the show with hair just those same colors. But to make it photograph better, we had to give her a blue rinse. Boy, was she sore.
Blue on top, huh? What about makeup? I suppose makeup is a big factor.
Oh, yes. Makes a big difference. Because otherwise, you see, you don't photograph with the right coloring. You see, and then, of course, I'll have to give you some jokes to tell.
I suppose the jokes will photograph blue. Oh, Ken, I'm sorry, I forgot. I want to introduce you to my protege, my new protege. She decided she wants to become a great actress in the theater, and she's trying to pattern herself after me. Come here, Margaret, sweetie. Margaret O'Brien, this is Mr. Murray.
Hello, Arthur.
Shall we dance? She sure is patterning herself after you, Tallulah. So, you want to act in the theater, Margaret? How old are you?
12.
That's my girl who said that. Ken, why don't you put Margaret on your show?
Well, I'd like to, but don't you think that she's a little Y-U-N-G? I'd rather have Y-O-U on my T-E-L-O... I mean, my T-O-L-I... How do you spell television?
Darling, when I go on television, it'll be spelled T-A-L-L-U-V-I-S-I-O-N.
Oh, Tallulah Vision, huh?
I've made up my mind to be in the theater like Tallulah.
Oh, what are you doing now, Margaret?
I'm between plays.
Oh, you've already been in some plays?
No, she's between her first play.
Well, have you seen any of the plays since you've been in town, Margaret?
Oh, yes, I went to see King Lear by Shakespeare.
That's a lot of laughs, isn't it?
And I saw the Cocktail Party by T.S. Eliot.
Good man, T.S. I've got his 5-foot bookshelf, you know.
And I saw Enemy of the People.
Starring Milton Berle, I suppose. Look, Margaret, didn't you go to see any of the lighter things? Some musical comedies, maybe?
Oh, no, I wouldn't go to musical comedies. They're so cheap, and the prices are so high, and besides, I couldn't get any tickets.
You're right, Margaret. I wanted to see one of the musicals this week.
I know the star of the show very well. She happened to be a personal enemy of mine. So I went to the producer and I asked him for a pair of tickets. And do you know that I couldn't get them for love or money?
Cholula, I've got a ticket broker who gets all the tickets to the theaters for me. He got me a couple for Guys or Dolls. Guys and Dolls, I think that is. Of course, I had to send him a nice Christmas present.
No, well, speaking of Guys and Dolls, we happen to have two of the stars of that show with us today. Vivian Blaine and Sam Levine. And after Vivian sings her song, Margaret, you ask her for a couple of tickets. I'm sure she has them. Meredith, darling. Darling Meredith, are you ready for Vivian Blaine's song?
Oh, sure. All set.
Hiya, Meredith.
Hello, Ken Murray. Well, as I always say, long time no see.
Yes, you do always say that, and that's why no long time no see. Meredith, I want to thank you for your Christmas present.
Oh, you're welcome, Ken. I wrapped it up pretty nicely, didn't you think?
Yes, I'm very sorry I can't use it. I don't sleep well on trains. You don't mind, I'm sure. I gave it to somebody for a Christmas present.
That one-way ticket is making a round trip. Meredith, what is Vivian Blaine going to sing, huh?
Well, Vivian has a wonderful arrangement of What Is This Thing Called Love.
Oh, that's wonderful. I love it. Ladies and gentlemen, Vivian Blaine with Meredith Wilson's orchestra and chorus in What Is This Thing Called Love. Congratulations, not only for your song, but for the enormous success you've made in Guys and Dolls.
Thank you very much. You're very kind, Tallulah.
Yes, I know. Now, look, Vivian, little Margaret here is interested in the story of your musical comedy. Why don't you tell her what it's all about?
Oh, I'm sorry, but I can't do that. We're not allowed to give away the plot.
Oh, you can't even give it away.
You're so wrong, Tallulah. We're selling out every performance.
I got in on a couple of passes.
Yes, that's what I heard. The manager made one, and the box office man made one.
You're just jealous because you can't get any tickets, and you're in the show.
It just so happens, Tallulah, darling, that I have two very good seats with me.
Yes, you have, darling.
And it might interest you to know that when I saw your show, I was sitting in the very front row. I'm sure you must have seen me.
Oh, no. I never look way up there.
And now, just a moment. Why is it that everyone who comes on the show starts thinking of me? I try to be special.
Oh, excuse me, Tallulah.
What is it, Margaret?
Let me, please. Hello, Vivian, darling.
Why, Margaret O'Brien, hello. Golly, I haven't seen you in years. Remember when I met you out in Hollywood when I was making pictures? Well, you remember. You must have seen me in State Fair.
Oh, yes, darling. You won a blue ribbon for that, didn't you?
That's my girl who said that.
Well, that's a new twist. Hiring a little girl to insult your guest.
Oh, no, Vivian. Margaret didn't really mean it. She's just trying to help me out. Very, very interested in seeing your play. Now, you said you had a couple of tickets.
Why, yes, indeed I have. I'll be glad to give them to her.
Oh, wonderful, darling. I hope she'll be able to understand it. The show is quite adult, I hear.
How old are you now, Margaret?
11.
Oh. Why, she'll be able to understand it, because by the time she can use these tickets, she'll be 15.
You have tickets 4 years in advance.
Why not? Every night there's a sign in front of the box office that says S-R-O, standing room only.
So what? When I was in Private Life, we had the S-R-O sign in the box office, too.
Yes, it was S-R-O. 6 rows only.
Just a minute. Just a minute. If you two dolls will excuse me.
Sam Levine.
I've been standing here listening to you two dolls beating each other's brains out. This one says she's got 2 seats. That one says, why don't you try standing room? The other one says it won a blue ribbon. So enough already. Now, what does this kid want, this little Miss Mark O'Brien?
All she wants, darling, is to buy 2 tickets to your show.
That's all?
Hmm?
For this, we went through this hoo-ha and mishmash with Vivian. Stop tumbling. 2 tickets to Guys and Dolls can be arranged.
Oh, do you mean you have 2 tickets?
Well, not with me. Who carries that much cash?
Well, you mean you know where you can get a pair of tickets?
What a question to ask, Sam Levine. Now, I'd like to ask you a question for your own information. Who has been on Broadway longer than I have? Oh, I'm sorry. That's an unfair question to ask you.
Mr. Levine, what is the point besides the one your hat is on?
Oh, you're going to start again with the 2 seats, huh? Look, Tallulah. What I'm trying to point out to one and all is that I happen to have connections with a certain highly placed gentleman who can put their dukes on a pair of ducats for a friend any time. And I happen to be that friend. All that it takes is a telephone call. I know the right people. I happen to be the star of the biggest hit on Broadway. And I have plenty of influence. So show me the telephone and give me a slug.
Don't tempt me.
Huh?
Sammy, you won't need a slug. Just pick up any phone here and make your call. This is NBC. They have thousands of telephones.
Thousands of phones? What a location for a bookie. Oh, when you stop to think how unfair life can be. I got a friend, Benny the Book, has 1 lousy telephone. They came and they tore it out by the roots. And besides, they arrested him.
Oh. Did they send him up the river?
No, it was his first offense. He's just up the creek.
Sammy, we're going to make a phone call. Here, use this one.
Okay. Yeah, I'm sure he'll be in. This is Sunday. They don't run anywhere on Sunday.
Sam, you're not calling a horse player to get tickets to your show.
Why not? He's a mutual friend of mine.
A $2 mutual friend of yours.
Well, I haven't seen him in months. The last time I saw him was, May, June, July, Saratoga, September. Oh, hello, Marvin. Oh, Irving. Oh, Marvin ain't there. Irving, this is Sam. Could you ask Joey to run across the street to Manny, Max, and Eddie's and ask Sal to send Marvin to the phone? Yeah, tell him it's Sam Levine. Sam Levine, the actor. All right, Sam Levine, the bum. What? Just for going across the street? Okay, I'll stand good for it. Go call him.
Look, Sam, if you're going to call every Tom, Dick, and Harry in town...
Who called Tom, Dick, and Harry? I called for Marvin, and Irving said he would send Joey to Manny, Max, and Eddie's.
All right, already. Let's get the tickets.
Okay, so Joey went to call Marvin. It's a person-to-person call.
That'll make the tickets cost $5 extra.
What's the $5 for?
Well, you can't expect Joey to walk across the street for nothing. He only makes $2.50 on it. The other $2.50 is for the premium for the accident insurance in case while he's crossing the street he should get knocked down by an automobile.
What am I doing in radio? I could get myself a pair of track shoes and I'm in business.
Look, Tululu, I'm doing this for you out of the goodness of my heart. Plus a small fee for incidentals. I wouldn't get tickets for anybody else in the world, but for you, I'm going to this trouble.
Well, if I'd known you had to put so many men on the job, I wouldn't have asked you. How long is it going to take?
It'll take only long enough for Joey to get Marvin and then to come to the phone.
Well, Joey should be back by now.
Well, look, figure it out. First, he's got to shave. Then he's got to put on a shirt and a tie.
Shave to go to Manny, Max, and Eddie's? What is it? One of those fancy restaurants where you can't eat unless you wear a tie?
At Manny, Max, and Eddie's, you cannot eat at any time. It's an auto supply store.
A formal auto supply store. You have to dress.
Well, they run a little handbook in the back. And they could get raided any minute. So how would Joey look in the lineup without a shave and a tie?
Ghastly, I'm sure.
By the way, I should mention, in case they are raided, there'll be an extra $500 added to the tickets. Bail.
Margaret, darling, won't you reconsider that one-way ticket to California?
Yes, maybe it would be cheaper. Meredith, can you give me that railroad ticket back?
Gee, I'd like to, Margaret, but I gave it to Ken Murray. Hey, Ken, if you're not going to use that railroad ticket, I...
Oh, I'm sorry, Meredith, but I gave the ticket away to somebody who did me a favor. Maybe I could get it back for you if I can use the phone.
Hello, Marvin. Oh, Joey. So where's Marvin? Look, I want you should get me right away a couple of tickets to Guys and Dolls. All right, Boys and Dolls. So where's Marvin? He left town. Somebody gave him a Christmas present. A one-way ticket to California. Oh, fine. Well, Tallulah, I tried and I failed. Now, there's only one thing left to do. Here, I'll give you these two tickets that I got in my pocket for tomorrow night.
Oh, Sam, you mean that you had those tickets in your pocket all the time?
Yeah, go ahead, take them. I'll let you have them for cost. $40.
$40 for a pair of theater tickets? Well, I'd rather wait till your scalper friend Marvin gets back. And I can get them from him for less than that.
Tallulah, don't be a schlemiel. Where do you think Marvin gets his tickets from?
Ladies and gentlemen, that was Meredith Wilson and his big show orchestra and chorus. We'll be back in a moment, darlings, just as soon as I ring my chime. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.
The Big Show. This is the National Broadcasting Company Sunday extravaganza with the most scintillating personalities in show business. The Big Show, the Sunday night feature of NBC's All-Star Festival, is brought to you by RCA Victor, world leader in radio, first in recorded music, first in television, and by the makers of Anacin for fast relief from pain of headache, neuritis, and neuralgia. The big stars on this program are Vivian Blaine, Jose Ferrer, Sam Levine, Ken Murray, Margaret O'Brien, Gloria Swanson, Fran Warren, Meredith Wilson, and the Big Show Orchestra and Chorus. And every week, your hostess, the glamorous, unpredictable Tallulah Bankhead.
Well, darlings, in a few hours, 1951 will be here. I've devoted this entire day to thinking of the things I've done this past year that I shouldn't have. And I've come up with the most darling resolutions. I can hardly wait till midnight to start breaking them. Meanwhile, our show goes on, and one of our guests, little Margaret O'Brien, keeps tagging after me because she's made up her mind she wants to be an actress in the theater, just like I am. I feel as if I'm her fairy grandmother. That should be godmother. That misprint was deliberate.
Oh, Tallulah.
Yes, Margaret, darling.
I just saw Gloria Swanson and Jose Ferrer come into the studio.
Yes, Margaret, yes, darling. They're going to do a scene later in the program from 20th Century, the play they're starring in on Broadway now. It's a drawing room comedy.
What's a drawing room comedy?
Drawing room comedy is... it's usually a play where a lot of rich people pay $6.60 to see a lot of poor actors acting like a lot of rich people.
Gee, it must be wonderful to be in a play on Broadway. I wish I was as great an actress as Gloria Swanson.
I beg your pardon, child. How about me?
Oh, I mean you, too. I wish we both were as great an actress as Gloria.
Darling, I love Gloria. No one better. Why, would we have very dear friends. But this is her very first play on Broadway. I've been in dozens of plays.
Oh, I know. I know them all. And what fun you must have had in them. Private Lives, The Little Foxes, Skin of Our Teeth, Dark Victory, Rain, Reflected Glory, Mr. Roberts.
Mom! I was never in Mr. Roberts. That's a play with all men in it.
I know, but wouldn't it be fun?
Why? Miss O'Brien, when I was your age, I never... what were you saying, darling?
I was just thinking how wonderful it would be to be a big star in the theater and have your pictures in all the papers and the magazines. I once saw your picture on the cover of Life magazine. How did you ever get them to put your picture on the cover of Life?
Well, someday, darling, I'll explain the facts of life.
Oh, I've been meaning to ask you. Can I have your autograph?
Why, of course, dear child.
Would you write it on these three pieces of paper?
Well, an autograph and triplicate, I am honored.
I need three because the kids outside the theater told me that for three Tallulah Bankheads, you can get one Gloria Swanson.
I was just stabbed.
Oh, I didn't mean what you think. I meant what I said. I mean, I meant because everybody wants your autograph. That's why I'd like three of them. And very few people want Gloria Swanson. You see? Does that sound better?
Darling, have you ever thought of giving up the theater and becoming a surgeon? You put that knife in so gently.
Hey, Tallulah.
Yes, Ken Murray?
I just saw Gloria Swanson and Jose Ferrer come into the studio.
Yeah, so I've been told.
Gee, that Gloria Swanson, she sure looks young for her age, doesn't she?
I look younger for my age than she does for her age. Dad, I did it. I knew it would happen. I finally insulted myself.
Now, wait a minute, Tallulah. Now, wait a minute. Let me figure that thing out. Now, if you say that you're younger for your age than she is for her age, then that makes you older age for age. Is that it?
What I meant is that I'm younger for the age I say I am than she is for the age she really is. And that's older than the age she says she is, or the age I really am. Yes.
Would you mind repeating that question?
Well, what I'm trying to explain, Ken, is you say she looks young for her age, and I said that I'm younger for the age I say I am than she is for the age she really is, which is older than the age she says she is, which is older than the age I really am. How many witches were in that sentence?
Only two.
Ken, may I ask you a question?
Why, yes, Margaret.
Why do you always hold that cigar when you're on stage?
Oh, I don't know. It's an old habit. Sort of puts me at ease. Here, have one. Try it.
Thank you.
Hello, Tallulah.
Well, Fran Warren, darling.
Say, you know who I just saw backstage? Gloria Swanson and Jose Ferrer. She looks so young for her age, doesn't she?
He looks pretty young for her age, too, darling. And, Fran, may I say that you look divine for your age, whatever it is. What are you going to sing for, sweetie pie?
I've got the right to sing the blues.
At her age, look who's got a right to sing the blues. Go ahead, darling, sing it.
Here's a word from RCA Victor. As we look ahead to the gigantic tasks our country must perform in 1951, it's clear that every individual's working life is going to be busier and more complicated than ever before. We're all going to need recreation in our home lives to erase the cares of each long day and recharge our batteries for the next one. That's where television fits in perfectly. And now is the time to see your RCA Victor dealer and choose from 18 beautiful models, each one seemingly more beautiful than the next. You'd do well to choose a 19-inch set for pictures that are wonderfully clear and big. Of course, they'll have that matchless quality which has made RCA Victor million-proof television far and away America's favorite. Here's wishing you RCA Victor Television. And with it, the high morale, which will help so much to make 1951 a happier year for everyone.
You know, darlings, the holiday season is traditionally a time of extraordinary excitement in the theater. But these holidays brought us a little more than the ordinary extraordinary. Anter, meaning American National Theatre and Academy, marked a red-letter day in its worthy history when it presented Gloria Swanson, Jose Ferrer, and an all-star cast in Mr. Ferrer's revival of that famous hit play of the 1931-32 season, 20th Century. So tremendous has been the public response that the play is moving over to the Fulton Theatre for an extended run. We'll give you a taste of the kind of evening you can look forward to at the Fulton by presenting now a scene from the play, starring Miss Swanson and Mr. Ferrer. Ladies and gentlemen, the curtain is up on 20th Century. Story of an eccentric Broadway producer named Oscar Jaffe and his meal ticket, a glamorous bundle of talent and temperament, Lily Garland. This is the story of an overnight train trip on the 20th Century Limited from Chicago to New York. We are several hours east of Toledo, Ohio, as the scene opens. Lily, played by Miss Gloria Swanson, feigns sleep in her apartment. Sadie, the watchful maid, is not at all surprised when the door opens and Oscar Jaffe, played by Mr. Jose Ferrer, reconnoisses the situation.
Not a word, Sadie. We must not wake her. Poor child, nobody understands her. She's very delicate. If you don't mind, I'll just sit here for a moment and breathe the air that surrounds her, look at her little possession, and remember things.
Sadie, who's in there?
No, I'm sorry I woke you up.
So it's you. You sneaked in while I was asleep.
What do you want, Scorpion?
If it makes you any happier to call me names, go right ahead.
Oscar, you're complete. You're the most horrible excuse for a human being that ever walked on two legs.
You've always misunderstood me, Lily. You lack the true intuitive gifts to appreciate great love.
Your philosophy of love doesn't interest me, Mr. Jaffe.
I'm an Oriental, Lily. Love blinded me. That was always the trouble between us as producer and artist.
Oh, so that's what it was it? How about your name in electric lights bigger than everybody's? Your grand illusions that you are a Shakespeare and Napoleon and the Grand Lama of Tibet all rolled into one.
You're absolutely right.
What?
I'm big enough to admit it. I never appreciated your real greatness until I lost you. Why, that last quibble we had about percentages, gad, how small, how cheap I was. What egotism, not to know that it was Lily Garland and not Oscar Jaffe.
Running all over town telling people that you had to put chalk marks on the stage so that I'd know where to stand. That you had to teach me to talk like a parrot.
God, it was despicable. I could cut my throat. But I've paid for it 1,000 times since. When I saw that last movie of yours, I only blamed myself.
Oh, you've seen it, eh? Well, you'll be glad to know that it's a tremendous success.
Oh,
I'm marvelous in it. Superb.
Don't say that, Lily, please. Don't.
Here, if you don't believe me, look at this.
Now, where did you get this dreadful thing? For bowling?
Well, read what it says.
The Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences. It's pathetic, isn't it? Don't fall for this sort of thing, Lily. There were moments in the film when you were marvelous. Yes, they couldn't stop the real Lily from coming through several times. But that cheap story, that clumsy, unimaginative director, well, he must have been related to the bank.
Well, you're right there. And you want to know why? The director was an idiot. I couldn't get anything into his head. I had to fight him all the time.
It was sacrilege to throw you away on a man like that. I wouldn't have him for my office boy. And the lighting in that picture. Don't you remember how I always brought the lights up every time you stepped on the stage? You became a radiant creature to the audience. People left the theater feeling that they had gone through some great spiritual experience. I left that movie house feeling that some magnificent ruby had been set in a platter of lard. You put yourself back 10 years, Lily, but we can mend that. You'll be greater than ever.
Listen, Oscar, if all this adages by any chance preliminary to a contract, you can save your breath because
Who
I'm not
Who said anything
interested.
About contracts? Shame on you, Lily.
What are you talking about? You'll do anything to get my name on a contract.
This billion trophy, this obscene lead statue must be doing things to you. I didn't come in here with contracts. I came with a dream we both had long ago. The thing we planned as a climax to your career. The last golden stair.
Look out.
The courtesan. The great courtesan role.
Oh, look out. Oh, no. So this is a big surprise you have for me. Another part where I'm unworthy of the lieutenant's love and make the great sacrifice.
I wouldn't sneer if I were you.
All right. What is it this time? Montezuma again or that big drama about Herc and Annie, the pride of the gas house?
No, Lily. It's none of these things. This happens to be the greatest woman of all time. Just her memory has kept the world weeping for centuries. The Magdalene.
Magdalene who?
Now, you listen to me, Lily Garland. I'm going to put on the passion play in New York with Lily Garland as Mary Magdalene. I've had it up my sleeve all this time, waiting for the right moment. The wickedest woman of her age. Sensual, heartless, and beautiful. Corrupting everything she touches, running the gamut from the gutter to glory. Can't you see her, Lily? This little wanton reduced to helplessness. Standing in the street, sobbing and wet through with her own tears. I'm going to have Pontius Pilate ride by in a chariot, and I'm going to splash mud all over her.
No, wait. A pilot sees me. He does a pay.
Yes.
His horse bolts. And Pontius is thrown out on his feet with a broken neck. Oh, and I smile through my tears.
Lily, that's an inspiration. Go on while you're in the creative mood.
Well, I'll tell you how I see the whole thing. I can see the Magdalene as a woman who was an aristocrat at the beginning.
Yes.
And after being brokenhearted by some man she loved madly and trusted, she went down, down, down.
Into the dead.
Hating and despising all men, laughing at them so cruel, so terribly cruel.
Yes, Lily, I'm going to make it my greatest production, gamble every penny on it. I've brought over an entire troupe from Europe, smuggled them across the Alps right through 4 iron curtains. It cost me my shirt, but I wanted them. 2 of them are geniuses.
No, wait a minute, Oscar.
Lily, if the play runs for 5 years, I won't make a dollar. You can have all the money. I only want to stagger New York. A desert scene with 100 camels and real sand brought over from the Holy Land. I'm going to have a Babylonian banquet that you give for your lover in the second act, the governor of Judea, Pontius Pilate, with your slaves all around you. You're covered with emeralds in that scene from head to foot. But that's nothing to the finish, where you stand in rags.
Rags?
In rags, and the Emperor Nero himself offers you half his empire. You answer him with a speech that is probably the greatest piece of literature ever written, and figured with love and practice, and all the lights just pouring down on you. Nero cringes. And the last we see of you is this little pathetic figure selling olives in the marketplace. It's really a sublime. Tell me, have I reached the artist in you? What is it?
You're crazy.
What do you mean?
Igor's listen to you, Oscar. You're a pure case of leaping paranoia.
Lily.
No, I am not angry. You're too funny to make anybody angry.
Don't be cheap, Lily.
Coming in here with a lot of camels and real sand from the Holy Land, you're a scream. You're going to put on the passion play. Oh, you haven't $100 to your name.
I can raise millions.
Yes, and I know how you intend to raise them. Get my name on a contract and go out peddling it. Take down some new angel on the strength of my reputation. Well, no, thank you. I'm through being your meal ticket.
You're at liberty to call up any one of my banks in the morning.
Your banks? You mean the ones that are taking your theaters away from you?
That's a lie. You've been listening to my enemy.
I've been listening to Mr. Oliver Webb, your so-called business manager, who broke in here with a sob story about that you were going to commit suicide unless I took pity on you. Well, you go on and commit it. It would be a blessing to all concerned.
Lily, what in heaven's name are you talking about? Mr. Webb is no longer with me. I fired him for stealing.
Oh, shut up. I've had enough of your lies.
Listen to me. I'm offering you your one last chance to become immortal.
Thank you, but I've decided to stay mortal with a responsible management. Max Jacobs.
I can't believe it.
No, read the papers in the morning,
Max. He's got paresis. I had to fire him to protect the health of my office force. He's a thief, besides. Illiterate, he can hardly write his name.
He writes it on text, all right, in great big text, too.
Oh, it's money you want. That's what you want. Just another Broadway hand, that's what you've become. I suppose if I jingle the miserable $10,000 or $15,000 in front of your nose, your mouth would begin to water. You'd start drooling and squealing. Gimme.
That's right, Oscar. Now get out of here before I have the porter thrown off the train.
Look out who gets thrown off the train.
Get out of here, you fake, you swindler, you!
Hit me, you cheap little shop
girl.
Get
out before I call the conductor.
Go on, ring that bell. I'll tell the world who's a fake you are. I made you. I taught you everything you know. Your voice, your walk, your cheap little talents, they're mine. I gave them to you. I gave up everything to breathe them into you. Even your name, Lily Garland, I gave you that.
Porter, Sadie, conductor!
Well, as soon as there's a God in heaven, Mildred Platter, you'll wind up where you belong, in burlesque.
You know!
Bring them on. I'll tell the whole train. I'll tell the whole world. Mildred Platter!
Conductor, throw this man out. Throw him off the train!
Gloria and Jose. Come here, darling. Come over here. That was such fun. That excerpt from your brilliant production of 20th Century.
Gee, thanks, Tallulah.
I find it a lot of fun working in the theater, Tallulah.
I bet you do. And Jose, you directed the play for Broadway, didn't you?
Well, as a matter of fact,
Oh, I read the wonderful notices the critics gave you.
Yes, they certainly were.
Not only for your direction, but for your acting.
Well, they were awful.
And I understand the theater's selling out, which would make you very happy.
Well, of course.
Oh, darling, I know you'd like to go on and just, we're telling us how wonderful your play is, but I simply must interrupt you.
Well, if you'd only give me a chance to say something, then you could interrupt me.
Well, of course, darling. Go right ahead.
Well, all I wanted to say was that I'd like to go up to my dressing room and change my shirt. I'll be back in a moment.
Oh, why, of course, darling. Go right ahead. You're ringing West. That's it, right there, darling. You gave a wonderful performance. You were superb and so beautifully directed. See you later, darling.
Bore.
Well, Gloria, it's so nice to have a motion picture star on the program who isn't here just to plug some picture she just made. Your picture was such an enormous success, darling, that doesn't need any plug. Well, what's the news from out in Hollywood?
You mean, what's new along Sunset Boulevard?
You slipped one in, didn't you, darling? Well, let's forget business and just talk some old-fashioned girl talk. Just between the two of us.
Mm. Yes, girl talk just between the three of us.
Oh, Margaret. I forgot all about you. Oh, Gloria, you know Margaret O'Brien, of course.
Yes, hello, Margaret.
Hello, Gloria, darling.
Margaret is going to become an actress in the theater.
Isn't that sweet?
Mm. Well, Gloria, I bet you must be exhausted from working in a theater. Oh, here, sweet, have a cigarette.
No, thank you, Tallulah. I don't care for one now.
Have a cigar, darling.
No, thank you, Margaret, darling. Cigar?
Oh, I just carry it to put me at my ease.
Well, Gloria, I was in Hollywood, you know, just a couple of weeks ago. I saw everybody, and everybody was talking
about... It's Navy. I'll say.
Well, everybody was talking about you-know-who.
Oh, yes. He's been behaving terribly, I hear.
Oh, terribly. He had the offense to come to the studio with the... What's her name?
With what's her name? Where was her husband?
Well, darling, he was driving that blonde hoosier down to Palm, or whatchamacallit.
Tallulah, no.
You don't say, darling.
Margaret, please, you don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, yes, I do. I've heard this story before.
What?
This is the first time I heard the details.
Well, may I ask, did you hear this story?
Oh, from some of the kids on the lot. Dean Stockwell, Lionel Barrymore.
That kid Lionel is incorrigible. I'm going to tell his kid Sister Ethel about it.
Oh, Tallulah, I almost forgot, and I don't know whether I should mention this or not, but I just read in the paper where that certain friend of yours got that wonderful award for the best motion picture performance of the year for the Critics Circle.
Which proves what I've always suspected. The Critics Circle is a bunch of squares. Well, don't you agree, darling?
Well, I'd like to, but I might want to make another picture in another 20 years.
Well, now, what was the matter with the picture you made, Sunset Street? I thought it was brilliant.
It's Sunset Boulevard, Tallulah.
Oh, well, I saw it in the neighborhood theater. Well, whatever it was called, it certainly deserved the award, because the same thing, you know, happened to me a few years ago when I made a magnificent picture.
Oh, yes, I saw it. Lifesaver, wasn't it? You were superb.
Lifeboat, darling.
Well, whatever flavor it was, I thought you gave the outstanding performance of the year.
Ladies, if I may say a word.
Oh, you bet, Jose.
Speaking of great pictures, you're forgetting a picture that I made this year, Cyrano de Bergerac.
Darling, don't stick your nose into this argument.
Well, I made a picture once called Journey from August, and I thought it would win the Critics Award. And when it didn't, did I write them a nasty letter?
This child will someday grow up to be the President of the United States.
If you would like to know a quick, easy way to ease the pain of a headache, neuritis, or neuralgia, then by all means, try Anacin. Your own dentist or physician may at one time or another have handed you an envelope containing Anacin tablets. Then you already know how incredibly fast and effectively Anacin brings relief. Anacin is like a doctor's prescription. That is, Anacin contains not just one, but a combination of medically proven active ingredients. For your own sake, try Anacin. Anacin is sold to you on this guarantee. If the first few tablets do not give you all the relief you want as fast as you want it, you may return the unused portion and your money will be refunded. You can get Anacin tablets at any drug counter. Anacin comes in handy boxes of 12 and 30 tablets and economical family-sized bottles of 50 and 100.
I want you to have a little talk with Margaret O'Brien. She's so interested in becoming an actress in the theater, and I really don't know of a more expert artist she can come to for advice.
Well, that's quite flattering, Tallulah.
I'd appreciate any help you can give me, Mr. Ferrer.
I know the child is quite young.
Nonsense. One of the greatest parts ever written was for a young girl, because the character was supposed to have been 14 years old. I'm referring, of course, to Juliet, of the immortal Romeo and Juliet. How old are you, child?
Oh, I just turned 14.
You know, you might well play it a bit.
Oh, this little girl played Juliet, Jose. Some of the greatest actresses of the theater played it. Jane Cowell, Judy Marlowe, Catherine Cornell, Miss Ethel Barrymore.
I know, Tallulah, but I've always thought it would be interesting to have the 14-year-old Juliet played by a 14-year-old actress. I wonder if you would read a scene with me, Margaret, the famous balcony scene.
Oh, may I?
Jose, are you mad? Now, how can a 14-year-old child run the gamut of emotion necessary to portray the exacting role of a girl torn from the arms of the man she loves, frustrated at every turn by parents who finally drive the lover to their destruction? What could this child possibly know about love? Why, When I was 14 years old, I never... Margaret, maybe you'd better try to play it, please.
Oh, excuse me, Tallulah. Before Mr. Ferrer and Miss O'Brien appear as Romeo and Juliet, I wish to say that this portion of the program was brought to you by RCA Victor, world leader in radio, first in recorded music, first in television, and by the makers of Anacin, for fast relief from pain of headache, neuritis, and neuralgia. Now, Tallulah, will you ring your chime?
This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.
This is The Big Show. And Margaret O'Brien, one of the guest stars, is about to realize her lifelong ambition to become an actress in a legitimate theater.
All right, everybody, on stage, a star is about to be born. I want you all to watch this. Vivian Blaine?
What's going on?
Jose Ferrer is going to act out a beautiful scene with Margaret O'Brien.
That guy is going to act with that little doll?
Vivian, what is this guys and dolls talk?
You mean that you don't know what a guy is and what a doll is? From the play of the same name where I talk like this?
No, I don't know what a guy is and a doll is from the play of the same name where you talk like that, darling.
Well, listen to me. I'll be glad to explain you.
Darling, they've been trying to explain me for years.
Well, Tallulah, darling, I'll explain you very simple. Do you ever go to Lindy's for a bite?
If I'm going to be bitten, I'd rather be bitten at the sport club.
What I mean is, do you ever go to eat at Lindy's?
No, I rarely dress for dinner.
Yes? Yeah? From this, a person can catch a cold.
Well, what about Lindy's?
Well, we'll say, for instance, Lindy is packed to the gills. It is impossible physically, if you'll pardon the expression, to squeeze, if you'll pardon the expression, another patient. But at one table for four are sitting two fellas, and the other two seats are bare.
If you'll pardon the expression.
Excuse me. So the two girls walk over to the table where the two fellas are sitting with the two bare seats. And they ask the two fellas politely, are the two bare seats occupied? But the fellas go on eating and don't even answer. Well, those two girls are dolls.
And the two men are guys.
They're slobs.
But if they invited the girls to have dinner with them, would they be guys?
Well, if it's Dutch treat, they're guys.
But if the guys paid for the girls' dinner?
Oh, well, those guys would be dolls.
So those are the kind of people that are in your show, guys and dolls. Would I fit into your show?
Well, if you were in our show, we'd have to call it Guys and Darlings.
Well, Vivian, although your explanation was confusing, I must admit it was quite dull.
Likewise, I'm sure.
And so let's get back to Margaret O'Brien and the part of Juliet. Vivian, have you seen Juliet?
Not since the show opened. I've been meaning to call her, but I've been so busy.
Vivian, dear, Juliet has been dead for years.
No kidding. Now, I'm really sorry I didn't call her. You know, a patient should never put off till tomorrow.
Yes, well, we all have to go sometime. Sam Levine, come over here. I want you to watch this, too.
What's the pitch?
Margaret O'Brien and Jose Ferrer are doing a scene from Romeo and Juliet.
And for this, you broke up my pinochle game.
Sam, it's a wonderful scene where Romeo meets Juliet on the balcony.
A very good place to meet a doll. I met more dolls in the balcony of Lois Pitkin Theater than this.
This balcony happens to be Lois Verona. And Ken Murray, wait a minute. Now, where are you sneaking off to? Aren't you interested in Romeo and Juliet?
Oh, sure. I'm smoking one now.
I'm talking about Jose Ferrer.
That's a good cigar, too.
I mean Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet.
Oh, yes, Tallulah. I'm sorry. I know it very well.
Oh, did you ever play Romeo and Juliet?
Oh, sure.
How did you do?
Ran second, paid $16.80 to play.
Chloe Swanson, Fran Warren, let's listen to Jose Ferrer play Romeo to Margaret O'Brien's Juliet. Go ahead, Jose.
Well, Margaret, are you familiar with the lines of the scene?
Oh, yes. We kids on the lot used to play Romeo and Juliet all the time.
I bet that Lionel Barrymore kid must have made a great Romeo.
Well, now, why don't we try a few lines from the scene that begins, but soft, what light through yonder window breaks? You remember?
Oh, yes.
soft? What light through yonder window breaks? It is the east, and Juliet is the sun. Arise, fair sun, and kill the envious moon, who is already sick and pale with grief that thou, her maid, art far more fair than she. Be not her maid, since she is envious. Her vestal livery is but sick and green, and none but fools do wear it. Cast it off. It is my lady. Oh, it is my love.
Ah, me.
She speaks. Oh, speak again, bright angel, for thou art as glorious to this night, being o'er my head, as is a winged messenger of heaven unto the white, upturned, wondering eyes of mortals that fall back to gaze on him when he bestrides the lacy pacing clouds and sails upon the bosom of the air.
Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou, Romeo? Deny thy father and refuse thy name. Oh, if thou wilt not, be but sworn, my love, and I'll no longer be a Capulet.
Shall I hear more, or shall I speak of this?
'Tis but thy name that is my enemy. Thou art thyself, though not a Montague. Oh, what's Montague? It is nor hand, nor foot, nor arm, nor face, nor any other part belonging to a man. Oh, be some other name. What's in the name? That which we call a rose by any other name would smell as sweet. So Romeo would, were he not Romeo called, retain that dear perfection which he owes without that title. So Romeo, doff thy name, and for thy name, which is no part of thee, take all myself.
I take thee at thy word. Call me but love, and I'll be new baptized. Henceforth I never will be Romeo.
What man art thou that thus be screened in night, so stumblest on my counsel?
By a name I know not how to tell thee who I am. My name, dear saint, is hateful to myself because it is an enemy to thee. Had I it written, I would tear the word.
My ears have not yet drunk 100 words of thy tongue's uttering. Yet I know the sound. Art thou not Romeo? And a Montague?
Neither, fair maid, if either thee dislike.
How camest thou hither? Tell me, and wherefore? Orchard walls are high and hard to climb, and the place death. Considering who thou art, if any of my kinsmen find thee here.
With love's light wings did I o'erperch these walls, for stony limits cannot hold love out. And what love can do, that dares love attempt. Therefore thy kinsmen are no less to me.
It is almost morning. I would have thee gone. And yet, no farther than a wanton bird, who lets it hop a little from her hand, and with a silk thread, tucks it back again, so loving and jealous of his liberty.
I would I were thy bird.
Sweet, so would I. Yes. I could kill thee with much cherishing. Good night. Good night. Parting is such sweet sorrow. But I shall say good night till it be morrow. Darling, and Jose, your little contribution was, as usual, divine. Isn't he sweet?
Just a minute, kid. I wouldn't bow that low if I were you. Your rubber panties are showing.
But, Tallulah, I was only acknowledging the plaudits of the multitude. I wish I had time to get to the famous death scene.
That might be arranged, darling. If you'll give me a moment to go out and get a little something, I'd like to see you do the poison drinking scene.
Oh, would you enjoy that, Tallulah?
To the dregs, dear.
Wait a minute. What are you picking on the kid for? I think she's done real good.
You think she done real good? I think she did real good.
All right, did real good. The little doll's got class.
But, Pam, darling, the role of Juliet should be played by an actress who has had much more experience than Margaret has had. She's so young.
All right, I'll give you that. She ain't no Irene did.
Irene done.
Well, make up your mind.
Juliet requires such a depth of perception, such inner fire. Oh, Margaret did very well indeed. But of course you can't expect a child to have the third dimension that I have.
Well, it's as broad as it's long. Personally, I think she made a fine Juliet. I'd like to hear you do it better.
I was wondering when you'd stop ad-libbing and get to that line. I'll show you a side of Juliet you never saw before.
From a balcony? All right, go ahead.
Oh, Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou, darling?
Here I am, Julie, right under the fire escape.
Deny thy father and refuse thy name.
Refuse my name? All right, so I'm Jessica Dragonette.
Oh, Stanley, stop that. Don't you know the romantic story of Romeo and Juliet?
Well, let me put it this way. No.
You've never heard of Romeo and Juliet?
So kill me, I never heard of it.
Sam, you're in the theater. Where have you been all these years?
Three man, a horse, room service, light up the sky, and now I'm in Guys and Dolls. But this Shakespeare, I don't dig already.
So don't dig it. Let him lay there already. And I'll tell you the story of Romeo and Juliet. Or as you would call it, a guy and a doll. And this guy, Romeo, comes from a wealthy family. The Montagues. They're in the woolen business.
Nice business, legit.
Yeah. And the Dawes family is well-heeled, too. Mm-hmm. The Capulet. They operate a chain of flower stores. And that's how she knows that a rose by another name. Still, if you'll pardon the expression, smells.
Mm. Well, that figures. And from the flower shops, they make money?
So, all right.
What?
They do a little bookmaking in back of the store.
Well, nuts.
So the guy and the doll, they got a yen for each other. But the families object.
Before they married, they already got mother-in-law trouble.
No, it ain't the mother-in-law's, it's the father's. You see, the old man is, Montague, he's in the woolen business. And old man Capulet is in the flower business.
So where's the competition?
The Montagues make suits without buttonholes in the lapels. And it's ruining the Capulet flower business.
Oh. What a lousy trick.
The guy and the doll want to get married, so they elope. And later the doll's father doesn't know she's married. So he wants her to marry another guy. So the doll lays down on the bed and makes it look like she's dead. And Romeo finds her and thinks she is dead, so he kills himself. Oh. And when the doll wakes up and she finds the guy has knocked himself off, so the doll knocks herself off. Well, that's the finish of the play.
That's the finish?
That is the finish.
Well, I don't know.
You don't know what?
If they got some big hit songs, it's got a chance. What's the name of that play again?
Death of a Woolen Salesman. What difference does it make? You wouldn't understand if I spent the rest of this year explaining it to you. And there isn't much left of this year. 1950 is almost over. And in a few hours, it'll be 1951. A new year. I don't know where the time goes. It seems there should be another month in the year to do all the things we forgot to do. A month to remember what we forgot. October, November, December, remember. It even rhymes, doesn't it, darling? A whole month of days to remember a kindly deed we should have done, a soft word we could have spoken, a friendly smile we should have restored. Jose, what do you think?
Well, I think that your month of remember should have at least 31 days. We could all use 31 days of grace devoted to undoing some of the unthinking things we did during the year.
Well said, Jose, and I think we can carry the idea further and make it a month for the whole world to stop and remember what a wonderful place this could be to live in if man would really be brother to man.
You're so right, Gloria. If the grown-ups would only take this month to remember, not to forget that the world they're making today is a world the kids of my age are going to have to live in tomorrow.
Margaret, that's a beautiful pitch. Every grifter on Broadway, every crumb on every street corner, every tin horn on 42nd Street. If we could only give them an extra month to remember, they might have less to try to forget and to go to sleep at night.
Yes, Sam. And with this extra month of remember, what a chance it would be for the guys and dolls on Broadway and in Hollywood to remember that there's a real world outside the little dream world they live in.
You're so right, Vivian. I sure could use that extra month just to sit around and remember all the kind and unselfish people who helped me up a few rungs of that long, rough ladder.
Fran, that's a beautiful sentiment. You know, I didn't think too kindly about this extra month at first. I got to thinking about the extra bills that would come in on the 1st of Remember and the income tax on Remember the 15th. But believe me, give me that extra month to remember some of the things I could have done better in the 12 months we've had. And I'll pay those extra bills.
Ken, you're right. But, Tallulah, you know what I would do if we could make this a universal month? I'd spend every one of the days talking to people everywhere in the world in the universal language, music.
Then tell the world, Nerdy, with some of the new and lovely words of that universal language, some of the great songs from some of the great shows of the year passed by. It's the big show medley of the big shows of 1950, opening with one of the newest and gayest from the most recent of musical hits, Meredith Wilson, the big show orchestra and chorus in Guys and Dolls.
What you doing with the basket on your arm?
I love you, a bushel and a peck, a bushel and a peck, and it beats me all the heck, beats me all the heck, how I'll ever tend the farm, ever tend the farm, when I want to keep my arm about you.
About you.
About you.
Talking all about you, can I live without you?
Cause I love you, a bushel and a peck, you bet your pretty neck I do. Cause I
I do.
From South Pacific, Vivian Blaine sings.
I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair. I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair. I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair and send him on his way. I'm gonna wave that man right out of my arms. I'm gonna wave that man right out of my arms. I'm gonna wave that man right out of my arms and send him on his way. Don't try to patch it up, tear it up, tear it up. Wash him out, dry him out, push him out, fly him out. Cancel him and let him go. I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair. Wash that man right out of my hair. I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair and send him on his way.
The big show chorus and orchestra in Meredith's arrangement of Irving Berlin's smash hit from Call Me Madam.
Put your head on my shoulder.
Still blossoming.
Fran Warren sings another great 1950 hit. Here's one of the best from History Kids. Stop the music, Meredith. You haven't heard yet from Tallulah. Here it is, darlings, my big song of 1950. Give my regards to Broadway. Remember me to Herald Square. Regards to old Broadway and say that I'll be there along. Oh, thank you, darling. Thank you, darling. And now I think it would be very nice if the orchestra and all the cast and everybody would sing Auld Lang Syne.
But, Miss Bankhead, we already did that.
You see, nobody ever tells me anything on this program. Oh, well, darlings, this winds up our New Year's show. And we asked you to be with us at this time next week when our stars will be Fred Allen, Marlena Dietrich, Portland Hoffer, Edward G. Robinson, Danny Thomas, Fran Warren, and others, and, of course, Meredith Wilson and his big show orchestra and chorus. Until then, may the good Lord bless and keep you, whether near or far away. Fran,
may you find that long-awaited golden day today.
Jose?
May your troubles all be small ones, and your fortune 10 times 10. Vivian?
May the good Lord bless and keep you till we meet again. Sam?
May you walk with sunlight shining and a bluebird in every tree. Meredith?
May there be a silver lining back of every cloud you see. Margaret?
Fill your dreams with sweet tomorrows. Never mind what might have been. Gloria?
May the good Lord bless and keep you till we meet again, Ken.
May you walk with the sunlight shining and a bluebird in every tree. May there be a silver lining back of every cloud you see.
Good Lord bless and keep you until we meet again.
May the good Lord bless and keep you till we meet.
Happy New Year, darlings.
Listen to the big show next Sunday when we'll have with us Fred Allen, Marlena Dietrich, Portland Hoffer, Edward G. Robinson, Danny Thomas, Fran Warren, Meredith Wilson and the Big Show Orchestra and Chorus, and others. And of course, as always, the glamorous, unpredictable Tallulah Bankhead. 20th Century was written by Ben Hecht and Charles MacArthur, based on a play by Bruce Charles Mulholland, and adapted for radio by Frank Ruth. The Big Show is directed and produced by D. Engelbach, and written by Goodman Ace, with George Foster and Mort Green. Phil and Alice.
later here at Theater Guild State Fair on NBC.
That was The Big Show as broadcasted on NBC on December 31, 1950. Radio City Playhouse is dramatic radio at its best. First appearing on September 25, 1948, this series was conceived as a showcase for what NBC termed good drama regardless of the renown of the playwright or of the play. The program was sustained, which is to say that the production costs were borne by the network rather than a sponsor. Absent the need to cater to a particular sponsor, director, Harry W. Junkin and producer Richard McDonagh had the latitude to produce works which were more literary in nature than the formula genre plays which were the mainstay of network radio. They took full advantage of this freedom to present plays ranging from the quirky comedy, Fanny, to the taut drama Long Distance, the series' premiere episode. Jan Miner's gripping performance in that play created a sensation reminiscent of Agnes Moorehead's triumph in the suspense production of Sorry, Wrong Number some 5 years earlier. The program last aired on New Year's Day, 1950. With a play written by Harry W. Junkin, appropriately entitled Reflections. Jan Miner appeared in this final show taking the female lead as a wife who, with her husband, spends New Year's Day reminiscing about their 32-year marriage. During its year-and-a-half run, the Radio City Playhouse marriage of superb writing, inspired acting and expert direction clearly achieved its goal of presenting good drama in the theater of the mind. We are fortunate to have the recordings which remain of this series to bear witness just how good radio can be. Here is Radio City Playhouse's Reflections as broadcasted on NBC on January 1, 1950.
The National Broadcasting Company presents Radio City Playhouse, Attraction 67, Reflection, as written and directed by Harry W. Junkin. Ladies and gentlemen, here is Harry W. Junkin.
Thank you, Fred, and a very happy new year to everyone. Since the past is composed entirely of memories, and since the future has not yet happened, the present perhaps is nothing more than a nostalgic mingling of the two elements. Our story today concerns the past and the present of three very nice people. Their present, of course, like yours, is today, this day, New Year's Day, 1950. Here is Jan Miner as Ann Stratton with Bryna Rayburn and Bob Haig in Reflection, Attraction 67 on Radio City Playhouse.
It's been a perfect New Year's Day, but I'm going home.
Oh, Maud, don't rush.
Yes, stay for a while. Now, you're not that tired.
I find your grandchildren rather exhausting.
It was rather hectic, wasn't it? I think everybody had a good time.
It's so wonderfully quiet now. Just the three of us together.
1950.
Hard to believe, isn't it?
How long has it been, Maud?
32 years.
It's a long time for three people to be friends.
Yes, it's a very long time. But here we are again. Maud and Peter and I. This is the 32nd time we've wished each other Happy New Year. I remember the first New Year's. It was 1918. You sailed for France that day, Peter. I remember how bleak it was and how miserable I felt. We'd been married 8 days and then you sailed for France. That was the day I met you, Maud. After his boat left, I wandered around in the rain, then went into some horrible, steamy little restaurant to have some coffee and get warm. And there you were, sitting at the table.
Excuse me, would you pass the salt, please? Thank you. Oh, anything wrong? No. Oh, no.
I suspect that what you need, dearie, is a drink. Women who eat all alone in third-rate restaurants on New Year's Day should get extremely drunk.
No, it's just the rain and...
Oh, look here. I'm sorry. Oh, it's none of my business. I'm just the gabby type. I didn't mean to pry.
Doesn't matter.
Is it somebody in the war?
My husband.
Oh, I am sorry.
I'll get used to it, I suppose.
Oh, had you been married long?
8 days.
Oh, then he isn't dead.
Oh, no. He isn't dead.
Oh.
Why do you say, oh, like that?
Well, I thought it was really something serious.
Serious? If you'd been married for 8 days and your husband went away to war, how would you feel about it?
Pretty badly, I suppose. Hand me the sugar.
Well, if you haven't been married, you can't imagine how you... You're not married, are you?
No.
Well, then.
I'm a widow.
Oh.
He was in the first contingent. He was killed.
Killed? Oh, no.
Oh, for goodness sake, stop blubbering all over everything. There are lots of other wives in the same case.
How dare you talk to me like that? Who do you think you are?
But I'm not trying to be nasty. I'm simply saying that there's no use bawling about it, especially in public. What do you do, anyway?
Do?
You work?
No, I don't.
Where are you from?
Boston.
Lived with your parents?
An aunt.
Going back to Boston?
I guess so. I don't want to, but what else can I do?
Work.
But I've never worked in my life. I've no experience.
You've got style. You're good looking. Know anything about clothes? Oh, no. Don't answer me. You only know how to buy them, not sell them. Oh, incidentally, my name's Maud Arnett.
I'm Ann Stratton.
Well, how do you do, Ann? And Happy New Year. Who else has a key to this apartment?
I got something terribly important to tell you.
You've been fired.
No.
You've ruined our dinner.
No.
All right, I'll bite. What is it?
Well, when you let me share your apartment, Maud, we agreed that everything had to be 50-50.
So?
Well, I won't be able to do that for much longer because I'm having a baby.
You're what?
Yes. A baby.
Suffering cats as if life weren't complicated enough.
Well, so I won't be able to stay on here. I'll have to quit my job.
No, wait a minute, little Annie Stratton. You'll move out of here over my dead body.
Oh, Maud, we can't have washing strung all over the place. It's too small. And anyway, I'm going to have to live on what Peter sends me. I just can't afford
it. Now, look, Anne. Gerald and I never had children, but I've always wanted to have a baby. If you'd sort of let me be around for this one, why, I'd get a... Well, I'd like it.
Maud, I just can't let
you... A baby! Suffering cats, you and I are going to have a baby. All right, I'm coming.
Why, it's Peter.
That's right.
But we didn't expect you until tomorrow night.
You're Maud, I take it.
Yeah, I know it's a bit of a shock, but... Well, don't stand there gawking. Come in.
You don't sound very glad to see me.
Oh, of course I'm glad to see you. It's just that Anne and I thought it was tomorrow night.
Where is she?
She's in the hospital. Father.
You mean I'm too late? Oh, no. Can I go and see her? Is she all right?
Mother and daughter are doing very well, and they'll be home tomorrow. You can't go and see her because they don't let even fathers into the hospital at this hour. You can sleep here tonight.
But you're alone, aren't you?
I'm perfectly harmless, and I'm a respectable widow. Now, don't be silly. This is 1918, not the Dark Ages. You can sleep in Anne's room. She'll be home tomorrow with Mary.
Mary? Is she pretty?
Well, as babies go, I suppose she's all right. I only saw her for a second.
And Anne's fine?
Anne is very fine.
Oh, gosh. Imagine me a father.
Peter...
Yes?
Yeah, I'm trying to phrase it as delicately as I can, but you will have a bath, won't you?
It's the 10 days on the boat. Uh-huh. Oh, you know, Maud, I think you and I are going to be good friends.
Well,
good friends. Oh, yes, Maud, you've been a good friend. I remember that the next New Year's, Peter and I had a little apartment of our own, and you came for dinner. We talked about what we'd do and how we'd make a great deal of money and be famous. We didn't do any of those things, did we? Wasn't it 1920 that you started your dress shop? And then the next year, Peter opened his brokerage business. You and I made the curtains, remember? We were so excited and pleased. 1925 was the first Christmas dinner we had in this house. Then, in 1929, what happened to everybody else happened to us.
I'm sorry to keep you waiting, but this place is going crazy.
Peter, what is it? What's going on?
The whole market's burst, like a bubble. Like a big, overinflated bubble. What do you want, Maud? I haven't much time.
Well, I wanted to borrow some money.
Oh, you too?
They'll sell my American Bellino unless I put up $8,000 margin.
$8,000 won't be enough, Maud. Some of our best securities have tumbled like bogus gold stocks. AT&T has dropped 100 points.
Oh, my...
Besides, I haven't anything like $8,000. In fact, we're not opening tomorrow.
Peter.
We're broke. Cleaned right out. Flat, busted, broke.
You can't mean it.
Outside of a couple of hundred Ann has in the household account, I have no money at all. None. There have been 16 million shares thrown on the market since it opened this morning. A man in this building shot himself.
Oh, Peter.
We're finished, Maud. It's over.
Oh, Peter, darling, you look so terrible. Why don't you go home? Have you told Ann?
I haven't seen her for 36 hours.
Peter, it isn't... I mean, you'll be able to, well, eat, won't you?
We'll be able to eat for as long as the 200 lasts.
I just can't believe it.
Nobody can believe it.
Well, I guess I'd better be going.
Sorry, I can't help.
Go home, Peter. Please, go home.
So that's it, darling. We've nothing left. We're poor.
No, we're not.
Look, I'm trying to make you understand. We have no money. I can't write a check for $5. Your household money is all we have.
No, Peter. We have much more than that. We've our health. We've three fine children.
Who like to eat regularly.
Shh. Now we've our health and our children and each other. I don't think we're poor. I think we're the richest people in the world. Then, for some years, there were New Years without turkey. They were lean years, working years. Slowly, we began to creep back to where we'd been. We began to make money again. By 1932, you'd acquired four stores, Maud. And Peter was back in the brokerage business. And then New Year's became a celebration again. Our children were growing up. It was in 1938, when she was 20, that Mary... Oh, Maud, you were good to Mary.
I love staying all night with you, Aunt Maud. You understand me.
I suppose your parents don't.
Oh, it isn't that, but they're stuffy. Sometimes I wonder if Mother and Dad were ever really in love. I mean, really.
You do you?
Dad's being deliberately selfish about Rex Stedman. His father left him almost $20,000 a year. Why should he work?
Mary, it's hard to explain, but... Well, it isn't natural for a boy of 22 to have no place to go.
Can't you understand that we love each other? As soon as I graduate, we're going to be married. If you'll wait that long.
If he wants you badly enough... He'll wait.
You don't know what it's like.
To be in love?
No. To be afraid. That he'd change. That he'd meet somebody else. If I ever thought that... And not if he should ever stop loving me, I'd just die. Honestly, I'd just die.
Please stop crying. Please.
Oh, Dad, please, if you'll just help me out of this, I'll never give you a moment's worry again, as long as I live.
Of course we'll help you, darling. Now, don't cry. There, there.
I don't even love him now.
You run along to bed. Your mother and I want to talk about this. Go on now, there's a good girl. And don't worry. Please, whatever you do, don't worry. And don't be afraid.
All right. Good night, Dad. Good night, Mother.
You should have said good night to her.
I can't stand to talk about it.
Anne, Mary thought she had a hold on something. Something fine and wonderful. It turned out badly. Well, she's only human. I suppose Rex Stedman is pretty dashing to a 20-year-old.
Of course she. After all we've done, after all we've given, we've been friends to our children, Peter.
Yes, we have.
We've done everything that any parents could possibly do. We've told her everything she's ever needed to know. I can't help it, Peter. You do everything you can for your children, and then they put a knife in your heart and just laugh about it. We're stuffy and conservative. Dull.
You can't bring your children up to be grateful. They didn't ask to be born. You can't scold her or criticize her. You've got to love her. Love her more than you ever have before.
Did you talk to this boy?
Yes, I don't think we want him in the family.
Well, will he marry her?
No. I'm afraid that now he doesn't really like Mary very much.
Then Maud, you took over. You whisked Mary off to Europe on a buying trip. Even though it seemed that a part of our hearts were broken for always, we soon got over it. The important thing was that Mary got over it, and you helped her. Oh, Maud, you've been good to my children. The next New Year's that I remember well was 1941. We were at war, but we hadn't been touched by it yet. That was to come later in the year. Susan, dear.
But, David, your mother and I and Susan and Mary and Maud are very proud of you. We've bought you a present, something you can always wear no matter where the Army sends you. You can wear it and think of us. And with it goes something we need no occasion to give you. All our love.
Yes.
Well,
oh, yes.
Open it, David, open it.
All right.
I know what it is.
Oh, little Miss Snoopy over here on my right. What? Gosh, a watch. Uh-huh. You know, Dad, when I saw this on your dresser yesterday, I was afraid it was a pen and pencil set.
Oh, you were looking ahead.
Do I have to make a speech?
Yes, you do.
Well, Mother, Dad, Maud, Mary, and Snoopy.
Snoopy.
Well, it certainly is wonderful. I can't say how much I... Oh, gosh, Mother, I can't make a speech. Give Susan her ice cream.
Oh, yeah.
Well, let's all go into the living room for our coffee. Peter, I think this occasion demands some of your very best brandy.
Say, that's a good
come
idea.
On, everybody.
Boy,
into the living room. Come,
I've
Susan.
Been saving it for something good.
David, wait a minute.
What is it, Maud?
I've something for you, David. Just from me. Here.
Maud? It's $100 bill.
When you get to London, you can have one on me. I'm not going to see you off. I don't like goodbyes in public. Be careful, David, won't you?
Next to Dorothy, you're my very best girl.
Well, go on into the living room then before I smear up my face. And if you let anything happen to you over there, I'll tan the hide off you. Come in, David.
We've only got about 10 minutes, Mother. Nearly ready?
Yes, dear. My, but you look wonderful in that uniform. I'm so glad they made you an officer.
Are you?
And you will be careful, won't you? Airplanes are so... Well, I wish you'd join something on the ground.
We'd better hurry.
David, you will be careful. No smart aleck stuff, no horseplay. No silly chances. Promise?
I promise. I'll be fine.
I know. You know how I know?
How?
Last night before I went to bed, I was thinking about you. Mothers are just, well, like that. I opened the Bible, and you know what it said? I memorized it. It said, I will deliver thee in that day, and thou shalt not be given unto the hand of the men of whom thou art afraid. For I will surely deliver thee, and thou shalt not fall by the sword, because thou hast put thy trust in me, saith the Lord.
Hi, anybody home?
Oh, hi, Dad. Dad, Mother's kind of upset. A telegram came about David from Washington. He's getting the Medal of Honor.
He's what?
Yes, the telegram just came this afternoon, but... Dad, take it easy. Mother's a bit emotional, you know. She just has never gotten over it, and that's all, and it sort of made it all come back.
That's you, dear?
Okay, Mary.
Mr. Hillsman phoned Peter. He wants you to call him as soon as you come in. Hello, dear.
What's this about a telegram?
It's on the mantle. If you don't mind, I think I'll go upstairs.
Wait, Anne, please. You might just as well face it, that he's dead. There's no use going on torturing yourself. He isn't missing anymore. He's dead. They told us that. They've found him and they've buried him. Mary, will you read the telegram? I have my glasses.
Yes, Dad. In the name of the 78th Congress... The President of the United States and the Chief of Staff of the United States Army Air Corps, on behalf of all ranks of the United States Army, takes pleasure in informing you that your son, the late Captain David Crandall Stratton, had been posthumously awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor for conspicuous gallantry above and beyond the call of duty while partaking in a bombing raid over Berlin on the 18th day...
Stop it! I don't want it. I don't want the medal. And I don't wish to discuss it anymore. Are you blind, Peter? Can't you see anything? What do I want with a medal? He's dead, isn't he? Then why can't they leave me alone and let me try to forget it? Now I'm going to see about dinner, and I don't want to talk about David ever again. Do you understand? Never, ever again.
Thank you, Peter, for being so understanding about David. You suffered as much as I did, but you didn't let me know it. The first New Year's after the war, as soon as it was possible, let me go to see his grave. You knew that I'd never gotten it straightened out, and you knew that I had to.
As far as we can drive, Mrs. Stratton, you'll have to walk the rest of the way.
You've been very kind, Captain. This is fine.
Shall I help you find it?
We have the location. Would you mind if we went by ourselves?
Of course not. I'll wait here. Take as long as you wish.
Come, Susan.
Yes, Mother. Mother, there are so many of them.
Yes.
I suppose we can be absolutely positive that it is David, can't we?
Yes, we can.
It's... such a beautiful place. I didn't think it would be this beautiful, did you?
Here it is.
It's just like all the others.
Yes. I don't quite know what I expected. But I thought it would be different. Somehow different as he was.
Shall I put the flowers on it?
No. I think I will.
Do you want me to go away?
No. I just want to stand here a moment and look at it.
All right.
Hello, David. Thank you for that trip, Peter. Seeing where he was buried made it easier to... Well, it gave it a sort of finality. Beautiful old French countryside and trees. And everything so well cared for. It made it easier to remember David as he was. Then the next year, Mary got married. The strange, sad love affair of a young girl was forgotten. It meant a lot to you, Maud, because Mary was always your favorite. When she got back from her honeymoon, she had you to lunch in her brand new house. Do you remember that lunch, Maud? It settled something for you that you'd never quite like to ask about.
Oh, it's a darling house, Mary. And a very good lunch.
Oh, I'm glad you liked it.
Mary.
Yes?
Mind if I ask you a personal question? Have I ever minded? Well, have you ever told George about, you know...
Yes. Yes, I have.
What did he say?
George is a very gentle man, Maud.
I know that, but what did he say?
He said that if I was her mother, she must have been a beautiful baby, and that he was sorry she hadn't lived because he'd have been proud to have her as a daughter.
What a kind thing to say.
I thought it was.
Thank you for telling me, Mary. It's only because, well, you're like my own flesh and blood, and I always wondered...
That's all right, Maud. I know how you feel. Of course, the color on that chair is perfectly horrible. Besides, nobody ever uses velour anymore.
So many, many New Year's days. Now with grandchildren. They were a little tiring, weren't they? We're back where we started now. Mary with her own family. Susan away at school. And the three of us getting slightly old. New Year's Day, 1950. 32 years of saying Happy New Year. And we really mean so much more. I wish we could find the words. Or I wish I could.
Peter, the fire's out.
Mm. Yeah, so it is.
Man, you're practically asleep.
No, not asleep. I've just been thinking with my eyes shut. I was thinking how long we've known each other.
Oh, what a depressing thought.
Maud. Peter?
Yes.
What, dear?
Happy New Year.
You have just heard Reflection, Attraction 67 on Radio City Playhouse. Jan Miner starred as Ann Stratton. Maud was Bryna Rayburn. Peter was Bob Haig. Other members of the cast included Rosemary Rice, Bill Lipton, and Joan Lazer. The music was composed by Dr. Roy Shield and conducted by Norman Clothier. The script was written, directed, and produced by Harry W. Junkin.
This is Harry Junkin again. On behalf of our cast, our engineer, Monroe J. Lawrence, our sound technician, John Powers, Norman Clothier, and the men in the orchestra, all of us connected with Radio City Playhouse, sincere good wishes for the best of everything in the coming year. Good afternoon, everybody.
What's on NBC tonight? Radio's outstanding dramatic program, Theater Guild on the Air, presents While the Sun Shines, starring Peter Lawford and Arthur Margotson. Following Theater Guild, keep tuned for the American Album of Familiar Music. Both are part of your great NBC Sunday. This is Fred Collins speaking. And now stay tuned for James Melton and Harvest of Stars on NBC.
That was Radio City Playhouse's Reflections as broadcasted on NBC on January 1, 1950. In early 1948, writer Cy Howard was fresh of the success of his first network hit, My Friend Irma, that had debuted on CBS the year before in 1947. It was quickly working its way to the top 20 ratings when Howard approached the network with a follow-up program. The new series, tentatively titled The Little Immigrant, followed the exploits of a newcomer from Italy, Luigi Bosco, who was making a new life for himself in Chicago. Here is Life with Luigi from December 27, 1947, entitled New Year's Phone Call.
We invite you to enjoy Life, Life with Luigi, a new comedy show created by Cy Howard and starring that celebrated actor, Mr. J. Carroll Nash, with Alan Reed as Pasquale. Vasco left Italy to start his new life in America. He promised his mother that he would write and tell her about his adventure. So now let's read Luigi's letter as he writes to Mama Vasco in Italy.
Dear Mamma Mia. In a few more days is going to be the new year. Reason I'm on this is because this week, 6 banks is sending me 3 calendars. And they all would like I should bring them some money. Mamma mia, I'm thinking it would be much better if I was to send them 3 calendars and they was to bring me money. But you should see these 6 calendars. 3 of them has got pictures of dogs. 1 has got a picture of a bank. Another has got a picture of the Grand Canyon. And the last one has got a picture of a beautiful girl. Mamma mia, she's wearing less clothes than Uncle Pietro's goat. Anyway, I'm going to need all these calendars, so I'm going to throw away 5 of them. Now I got something on my wall I'm always wanted. Picture of the Grand Canyon. Someday, Mamma Mia, maybe you come to America, and you're going to see how the people here, they celebrate the New Year's. Dancing and singing and hollering and whistling. Then at 12 o'clock at midnight, the lights go out, the fellas is a kiss of the girls is a kiss of the fellas. Everybody is a kiss. This is a democracy. Last New Year's Eve, when the lights was a go out, I was standing next to Pasquale's fat Dora Rosa. Mamma mia, I'm a thought that the whole of democracy was a fall on me. But I'm sure I'm going to have a good time at this New Year's. But one thing would make it perfect. In America, is the custom on a New Year's Eve, everybody is a call up his mama and a wish you a happy New Year. Oh, I wish I had enough money to call you up and hear your voice again. Well, it's no use to dream, but besides, it's the time I should go to my night school class. So I'm going to finish this letter later.
All right, class. Quiet, quiet. Good. Now I'll call the roll. Mr. Basco?
Here.
Mr. Horowitz?
Here.
Mr. Olson?
Here.
Mr. Schultz?
Why not?
Well, look,
click on the trigger, my name should be Roy Rogers.
Mr. Schultz, please. Now, class, our lesson today is geography, and we will review the important rivers of the United States. Mr. Horowitz, you may name the 8 great rivers.
With pleasure. The Mississippi, the Potomac, the Delaware, the Ohio,
I'll give you a hint. There's one river associated with the name of an automobile.
You mean there's a Flivver River?
No. It's the Hudson.
Oh, I've stepped down into that one plenty of times.
All right, Mr. Schultz. Now, let's see if you can name another river.
The Missouri.
Well, good for you. That's excellent. Wonderful.
No, don't tell me. Just put it down on the report card.
Well, we have 5 rivers now. Can you name the other 3, Mr. Schultz?
Well, there's the Suwannee.
The Suwannee is not an important river, Mr. Schultz.
Oh, Al Schulzen should hear you say that.
Please, please, Mr. Schultz. Now, who can name the other 3 rivers? Mr. Basco?
Huh? Miss Spaulding, if you wish, I could give you the whole correct answer.
Well, please do, Mr. Olson.
Yo-ho. Miss Spaulding, shall I name the 8 rivers alphabetically or according to size?
Just call out their names, Olson, and they'll answer present.
Oh, keep quiet, Olson. Learn something. The rivers are the Hudson, the Delaware, the Potomac, the Mississippi, the Ohio, the Missouri, the Columbia, and the Colorado.
Good for you.
Yo-ho. I might also add, other great rivers include the Susquehanna River, the St. Lawrence, the James, the Cumberland River.
Thank goodness he's passing through a dry state now.
Sure, you are just jealous of my knowledge of geography. Instead of acting like a jackass, why don't you be something like me? Studying and reading and learning. But I bet you I have 100 books in my head.
Look at him, what a horrible-looking bookcase.
Mr. Schultz, that will be enough. You could spend more time studying. And that goes for you, too, Mr. Horowitz. And you, Mr. Basco.
Mississippi, the Ohio, the Mr. Hudson.
Mr. Basco, we've had the answer. What are you thinking about, anyway?
Oh, excuse me, Miss Spaulding, but as soon as it's going to be New Year's Eve, and I'm going to have enough for money to call my mama on the telephone.
Oh,
poor Luigi. He is homesick.
Stop, Olson. Luigi is here with us. How can he be homesick? Luigi, I'm just trying to cheer you up.
Luigi, how much would it cost to make a telephone call from Chicago to Italy? Well, how much does it cost to make a
call?
Yeah,
how much?
I was asked a long-distance operator. She told me it's the cost with the government to tax $15 the first 3 minutes, $5 each the next minute.
Ach, if you give a hiccup by mistake, you lost $3.
Yes, it is quite expensive. If you should speak to your mother for only 10 minutes, it would cost about $50.
Gee, that's a lot of money for a phone call.
True, true. But when you want to talk to your mother, $1,000 ain't too much. Wait, Luigi, I got an idea for you. Huh? Why don't you lend the $50 from your friend Pasquale?
Mr. Horowitz, it is not lend. It is borrow $50 from Pasquale.
What's the difference? Either way, he ain't going to get it. Luigi, I got it a better idea. Go into Pasquale's store when he's not there and make the call on his telephone.
No, thanks, Schultz. But now I'm going to know what I'm going to do. It's hard to get money from a Pasquale, but maybe he's going to let me use his telephone, and when the bill is to come, I'm going to pay him out little by little.
That's a good idea, Luigi. Luigi, are you a smart cop? Smile. And what if you don't pay him back so quick? What can Pasquale do to you? Can he sue you in court? Can he take away your store? Can he make you marry his daughter, Rosa?
Sure, can he?
About the zooing in the house, I don't know. But about Rosa, on that I can give you my guarantee.
Luigi, my friend. Hello, Luigi. Hello, hello.
Hello, Pasquale. Pasquale.
I want to ask you a bigger favor about a New Year's Eve.
Sure, little banana nose. You know anything I'm a god is yours, and my house, and my food, and my clothes, my daughter Rosa.
Well, Pasquale, thank you very much for your house, and your food, and your clothes.
What about my daughter Rosa?
You're welcome. No, Pasquale, please forget about her.
I will, after you marry her.
Pasquale, I'm coming here to ask you a bigger favor for it, so let us not to fight.
All right. What's your bigger favor, money?
Well, there's a phone call I'm like to make tomorrow night with your telephone.
All right. Who are you going to call?
Italy.
What, are you crazy? People don't call up countries, they call up people.
Huh?
What are you going to do, call up Italy and say, hello, Italy, what do you hear from the Alps? That's crazy.
No, Pasquale, you don't give me a chance to explain. I would like to call my mama on a New Year's Eve.
On my telephone, that's a cost about $1,000.
No, Pasquale, only about $50. And I'm a promise you I'm going to pay you back.
Luigi, maybe we'll make a little deal.
Huh?
You know, on the outside, I'm looking like I'm a hard man, but deeper down, you know, I'm filled with the milk of human kindness. And for you, there's always a couple of big squirts.
Oh, thank you, Pasquale. You're the biggest squirt I know.
That's a funny thing. When I'm a say it, it's a come out of different.
Yeah, but Pasquale, what is this deal you was talking about?
Well, Luigi, it's a strictly business. I'm willing to lend you the $50 for my own personal loan company. The Pasquale Finance Corporation.
Oh, thank you, Pasquale.
And as long as it's going to be business, you got to have a co-signer. Somebody who's married.
Well, all right, I'm going to get a Schultz.
No, it must be a female married, the co-signer.
Well, all right, Mrs. Schultz.
Also, she's got to be married to my son-in-law, and his name is got to be Luigi.
Pasquale, you mean to get us some money? I'm going to marry Rosa?
Hello, my son. Goodbye, Papa.
No, Pasquale, you give me a good idea. I'm going to the real finance company and get to this loan of my son.
Who's going to give you a loan, you broken darling? Wait. Luigi, I'm not got no hard feelings. Matter of fact, I'm got a bigger pull with the businessman's loan company on a 4th of the Dearborn.
Huh?
You get down there right away now. You mention my name as your co-signer. You get the money in a minute.
Oh, thank you, Pasquale. I'm glad you're not married to me. I'm going down there right now.
Sure. Go. Sure, I'm going to help him get that money. I'm just giving him enough rope so he's electrocuted himself. Hello, a businessman who owns a company? Oh, Mr. Fantetti, hello, that's a Pasquale. I'm just to send a friend down to see you. His name is Luigi Bosco. He's a very nice little pumpkin head. Yeah, I'm going to co-sign his loan for him because he's got a very fine character. Oh, yes, he's just got a new job. He's working in a pool room. Also, in his spare time, he's laying a chiggy for a float in the crab game. Oh, this boy's a full of talent, yes. Huh? What he wants to use the loan of money for? Well, you see, right now, he's a little short. But I guarantee if his horse wins the race, you're going to get all your money back with interest. You going to give the loan? Hello? They hung up on me. I wonder why.
And now for the second act of Luigi Basco's Adventures in Chicago, we turn to page 2 of his letter to his mother in Italy.
And so, Mamma Mia, I'm a went to that loan company. Sign outside, as I said, Business of Manzalona Company. Who will lend you $100 and your signature? I figured out I'm going to write only my first name and I take a 50. But then a man inside is asking me a lot of questions. How much money am I got in the bank? Stocks, bonds, and insurance. Then he's add up all of these things, and he's find out I'm worth nothing. This I could have told him when I walked in. But then he says, who's your cosigner? And I'm told him a Pasquale. Next thing I know, I'm on the street, the car going home. Well, mamma mia, in a few more hours, it's going to be New Year's Eve. And a lot of Americans, they're going to be telephoning their mamas to say hello. But not to me, because I'm still not able to get money for the phone call.
Luigi, my fellow boob.
Hello. Hello, Schultz.
Well, how did you make it out, Miss Pasquale?
Schultz, I don't understand what's happening. Because I'm no one to marry Rossi. He's no one to give him the money, so he's sending me to the finance company. But they don't want to lend me the money to anybody who's a shiny shoes in a pool room and is a co-signer is a horse.
Ach, Luigi, are you for shimmers?
Sure, so what am I going to do? I'm feeling terrible.
What can you do? Smile, Luigi. So if it ain't this year, maybe you'll call her next year. Anyway, I ain't going to let you be so depressed. Tonight, me and my happy little family, we are having a New Year's Eve party, and you are going to join us.
Well, thanks, Schultz, but I'm not...
Stop! You're going to love it! But there'll be me, my wife, my three children, cousin Hugo, Uncle Tom, my brother Wolfgang, his wife, their two children, Uncle Karl, Aunt Frieda, the four little nephews, my grandfather Max, his girlfriend, and the rest of the family.
But Schultz, you only got two rooms. How you going to make a room for so much people?
It's New Year's Eve, so we raise the roof. Oh, smile, Luigi. But what do you say? Are you coming to my party?
Sure, it's nice you should invite me, but...
No buts. Ach, Luigi, we got in such fun every New Year's Eve. There will be food and drink and balloons and crazy hats and horns and the radio always playing and the kids hollering.
Yeah, but sure, so what about the neighbors?
Let them make their own party. Oh, Luigi, we got in such fun at 12 o'clock sharp. Grandpa Max goes around and kisses everybody in the room. Oh, and when he does that, I laugh hysterically.
Why, Schultz?
His beard tickles my chin. Ach, Luigi, I see it's no use. That phone call is on your mind. But remember, any time tonight, the fun is waiting for you.
Well, thank you, Schultz.
Good, good. Now, give me a smile before I leave. That's better. Now, be like me, Luigi. Happy. Always laughing. My rheumatism is killing me.
Well, soon everybody's going to be calling their mamas and not to me. If the telephone company was only to know how much I'm a miss of this, they would surely lend me one long distance call. They would lend me one long distance call. Sure, why not? Mamma mia, it's only 4 o'clock. The companies are not closing yet. I'm going to downtown right now and talk with the president of the telephone company. Oh, look at the streets. Already people are starting to celebrate. Oh, there's the telephone company. This is so big. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, 12, 15, 16 windows in the ground floor. Well, is it no use to stand outside? I'm going to go in. Pardon me, lady.
Yes?
You work for this telephone company?
That's right. I'm a chief operator.
I'm a Luigi Basco, State 4271. Are you recognizing my voice?
Hardly.
I've got to report for duty upstairs. Whom do you wish to see?
Well, I was thinking I would like to see the president, a fellow who's on the telephones, Mr. Bell.
Mr. Bell? Oh, you can't be serious. He died years ago.
Oh, poor fella. Better maybe I can see Mrs. Bell.
She's dead, too.
Mr. and Mrs. Isabella, they had some sons?
Well, I would imagine so.
Well, good. Then, please, maybe I speak to one of the Bell boys.
Sir, maybe I could help you if you told me what you came here about.
Well, it's about a telephone call. It's a telephone call I'm a wanna borrow because it's soon New Year's Eve. And I ain't got the cash to pay for long distance to call it to my mama, me, in Italy.
Oh, well, are you a customer?
Oh, sure. Whenever I'm going to make a call, I'm going to use only the telephone.
I think the man you want to see is Mr. Hawkins. His office is right down the hall.
Oh, thank you. And you know, you're a very pretty girl.
Thank you. What did you say was your problem?
That's all right. I'm going to see the man. Mr. Hopkins, hope he's a nice man. What is a hurt to nothing to ask? Ah, here. Robert E. Hawkins, general manager. Man who manages the generals must be pretty important. Well, I'm going.
Yes?
Hello.
Who are you?
Luigi Basco, State 42701. Remember? Every month you send me a bill.
Well, have a seat, Mr. Basco. I'll join you in a minute.
What?
I said have a seat. I'll join you in a minute.
You think this chair is going to hold the both of us?
Now, Mr. Basco, you came here for a reason. What is it?
Oh, it's a very important, Mr. Hopkins. It's a very big favor I'm going to ask you.
Yes?
Oh, thank you. I didn't think you would say yes so quick.
Mr. Basco, what did you come here for?
Well, a few hours is going to be New Year's Eve. And everybody, they're going to call up with their mamas to wish them a happy New Year.
Yes, that's very true. As a matter of fact, I'm going to do that very thing myself.
Well, I'm going to telephone Mr. Hawkins, and I'm going to like to call my mom in Italy. But is it going to cost $50?
I get it.
Oh, no, you're not going to get it because I'm going to get it. You see, $50 is more than I can afford to pay in 1 month.
Well, what did you expect me to do about it?
Lend me the telephone call.
What?
Sure. Just don't put on the bill. And instead, I'm going to pay you out the $4.50 a month for a year. Or maybe, if you like, every week, I'm going to bring a dollar to your house.
Mr. Basco, please.
Don't say no. I'm going to give you $3 a deposit right now.
I can.
Then I'm not talking to my mom for 10 minutes. I'm talking for 8 minutes.
No.
Wait. I'm going to ask her about Uncle Pietro and his goat. So it's going to take only 5 minutes.
Mr. Basco.
How much does it cost if I'm just to say hello and a goodbye?
I'm very sorry, Mr. Basco. Really, I'd like to help you out, but I'm part of a big business concern, and things aren't done that way.
I'm understanding, Mr. Hawkins.
No hard feelings, I trust.
You trust, oh good, I'm going to pay you back every week. I'm
Mr. Basco, I'm afraid you misunderstood. I can't help you.
Huh? Oh. Well, goodbye, Mr. Hawkins. And just the same as always, I'm still going to do all of my telephone business with your company. Goodbye. Mamma mia, I'm going to try everything, but it looks like it's no use. I'm not going to be able to make the call. Well, and now I'm going to go outside and go home. Oh, look at those crowds. Still not the 12 o'clock of midnight already. Everybody's in the streets.
Happy New Year, buddy.
Thank you, and a Happy New Year to you, too.
What'd you say?
Nothing.
What's the matter? You a wise guy?
No.
You want to start a fight?
No, I'm going to go home.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, lady. Happy New Year. Well, I'm opening up.
go into my store, maybe go to sleep.
Hi, buddy. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Hey, wait a minute. Let's celebrate. How's about a nightcap?
No, thanks. I'm a never sleeper with a hat.
Hey, you're in a worse condition than I am.
Excuse me. I'm going inside of my store.
Hello, what's your hurry? What's your hurry?
Oh, it's so bad. Poor man, is there something wrong?
No. It's just that every New Year's Eve I get to think of my mother. Oh, my mother, she was just like a father to me. My father, he was just like a mother to me. You know, for the last 3 years, I've been going to a psychoanalyst. And that's no good.
Why?
He's just like a brother to me.
Well, that's too bad. Happy New Year, and I'm hope everything is a straighten out for you.
Straighten out? Ain't I stiff enough?
Well, I... Poor man, I'm a better drag him in a hallway.
Luigi, that's no way to get a money for the telephone call, rolling the drunks.
No, Pasquale. I'm going to give up all ideas about the phone call. Now, if you don't mind, I'm going into my store and I'm going to sleep.
Sleep? What are you talking? A few minutes, it's going to be midnight. Let's celebrate.
No, Pasquale, I'm going to feel like to celebrate.
Oh, stop. Don't say such a thing. Let's me and you and Rosa, we go walking on a Michigan Boulevard. We watch Rosa push in the crowd a little, eh? Don't answer. I call her in now. Rosa! Rosa! Rosa!
You called me!
Yes, my little Cupid doll. Rosa, say hello to Luigi.
Hello, Luigi.
Hello, Rosa.
Rosa, any minute is it going to be 12 o'clock? What are you going to do?
Same as last year, Papa.
What's that?
You hold Luigi and I'll kiss him.
Right. And then it's 12 o'clock. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
All right, listen, they're ringing out at 12 o'clock. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
Pasquale, please, close the door, huh?
All right. Listen, Luigi, just because he's American, a custom on a New Year's Eve for a son and to call his mama, that's the meaning. You've got to do it. The whole thing is a trick put out by the telephone company. I forget about it. Hey, it's a telephone. Luigi, answer your telephone.
Hey, so maybe Schultz wants I should have come to his party. I'm going to feel like it.
Oh, Schultz. Well, forget about it. He's giving up. Let's just start again. Luigi, answer, please, the telephone.
Well, all right. Hello? Yeah, it's Luigi Bosco, 21 and North Hollister Street. What? Who's calling to me?
Italy! Yeah, I'm a hold on.
Come, Rosa, let's go.
Yeah, sure, I'm a hold on. Mamma mia! Oh, how wonderful. Mamma mia, how you feel, huh? Yeah, isn't it a wonderful telephone? Yeah, sounds like we're next door to each other. Mamma mia, how you feel? That's good, good. And I have Aunt Margarita and Uncle Pietro and his goat. Oh, the goat is still not married. Mamma mia, it's beautiful to hear your voice. This is so nice, Mamma mia. Wait. Who's paying for this telephone call? Pasquale is surprising me? No? Then wait. That a man from a telephone company, he's a fix-up. No? Then, Mamma mia, how's it possible? Who's paid? What? Out of towns of people from Castellamare?
Why? Oh, I'm a forgot. In the Castellamare, is it the custom on a New Year's Eve? The mama should call the son.
Life with Luigi is a Cy Howard production. It was written by Mack Benoff and Lou Derman and directed by Mack Benoff. Jay Carroll as the star as Luigi Ballasco with Alan Davis Pasquale. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
That was Life with Luigi from December 27, 1947, entitled New Year's Phone Call on CBS. Here is Matinee with Bob and Ray from December 31st, 1949.
Matinee with Bob and Ray. Good afternoon and welcome, everybody, to another Gay Sturdly. Our last program in 1949. Didn't it scare you? Yeah, the last program of this decade, the last one of this half century. The last one in the 1940s. Matinee with Bob and Ray, a public service presented by Harvard University. Today's prize-winning script submitted by President Conant.
In case we don't get here Monday, Happy New Year, everybody.
We'll be here Monday, or else. As you know, we can both be replaced.
We can both be counted on to be here Monday.
Just remember that if this job is too big for us, we can leave, Bob. And I want to make that abundantly clear.
That's what we've been told.
And you musicians, though, before I say another thing, I want to thank you all for what you've done to me this year.
You remember the first part of the year, Ken and Bill introduced a great new song. Ken played it, I believe, first as a solo. We're going back over the highlights of the last year.
Sounded just like that last January.
That's right,
too.
And he's had a year to practice it, but it still sounds just as bad.
Hello? Yeah, it's of course.
We made a very historic phone call
Excuse me, Ma Perkins is on the phone, Bob. She wants to know what to do with Shuffle. He's prematurely celebrating the holiday.
Give him the weekend off.
Take the weekend off. Tell him to take the weekend off, Ma.
Thanks, Ray.
Quiet, Shuffle. Yeah, okay, Ma.
Hello, I'm right here and I'm all right.
Uh-oh. Ma Perkins tells me that she's under federal indictment for peddling green lumber from the old lumberyard, Bob.
Well, we'll have to wait for Monday to find out what happens to her, I guess.
No, we won't. As a matter of fact, she's telling me now.
Oh, she is?
Yeah. But I can't tell. That would be breaking some sort of a code in radio.
Breaking a cliffhanger or something.
Incidentally, Cliffhanger, as you all know, friends, is a great musician.
Thanks, Ray.
And welcome, Cliff, to our program.
Well, sir, it's been quite a long while.
Wait a minute, I didn't say goodbye. Goodbye, Ma Perkins.
Bye, Ray.
How are
you? It's been quite a long while since my first visit up here this year, but it was an auspicious one.
It certainly was. And do you want that pivot tooth back?
Thanks very much.
I'd suggest you don't use the word auspicious anymore.
Don't use the word auspicious?
You don't look good when you say it, you know?
Oh, okay.
You look kind of excited about it.
Righto.
Try some other word, like fright. Let me hear you say that.
Fright. F-R-I-T-E. Fright.
Well, you don't... We're not running...
Falderal. P-H-O-L-D...
No spelling.
What day was our great spelling bee this past year?
Well, that was one great program we had. You all remember our spelling bee when we had some very talented young men and young women.
The winner of our spelling bee was little Harvey Crumlift, who's here today.
Thanks a lot, Bob.
Tell us his
amazing
story.
Hello, everybody. It's grand to be back. Back with you all.
What was the word that tripped you up, Harvey?
Falderal.
And did you finally get the correct spelling of it?
Finally, I got it down pretty good. Falderal. F-O-L. Falderal. Capital F-O-L. Hyphen. D. Falderal.
Try once more.
Small F-O-L-D-E-A.
Yeah.
Falderal. P-H-A-O-L-D.
I'm sorry. Doesn't look as if you've progressed much in the last
year
either.
I've got a Kimbo down now.
A Kimbo?
A-K-I-M-B-O-U-G-H.
Right. A Kimbo. Okay. And that's Harvey Crumlift. We'll hear from him in a
minute. Juxtaposition. J. Capital J-U-X.
That's a small J.
Small J. Juxtaposition. Small J-U-X. T.
T-A.
Juxtaposition. I don't know. I'm sorry, sir.
Well, that's all right. You keep it up, will you?
I can't get that.
Maybe
one.
Your spelling will improve. What else did we do? What was another big thing we did? We were at several historic things. Bob and Ray is there.
Bob and Ray is there. We presented the famous Battle of Crumlift.
Remember back in July, we called in our on-the-scene reporter at the Battle of Crumlift?
June 4th, 1530. The Battle of Crumlift. Bob and Ray is there. Hold up, steady.
I'm speaking to you from my vantage point high atop a wall here on the commanding hill looking over the position where pretty soon the soldiers of the opposing army will probably be riding up. I believe I hear the band coming down the field now, and let's turn down there on the field, see if we can pick up some of this band music.
Napoleon's troops are attired in gay red ballet slippers. And also muskets.
Excuse me, Ray, for butting in. I believe there's another band approaching me here.
Before we swing down for that band music, Bob.
Before I excuse you, did you have something to say?
Yes, I did. I brought one of the commanding generals here to the microphone for you to interview.
All right, sir, and your name is what, please?
Bob Montefiore, fine.
Of course, you understand he speaks in another language. Foreign language, and we can't understand just what it is he is saying. But we are here. And I believe there's another band coming down the field. Oh, they passed by and we
didn't... Excuse me, did this phone ring?
Yes, I think it did.
Hello.
Hello, Ray.
Hello, Mom. How's everything?
Hello, Mom.
You're interrupting. We're running down through some of the great programs of 1949.
Yeah, yeah.
And, I believe if you could call back, say, at 1:31 or 2, we could talk with you.
All right.
Is that all right?
All right, Elizabeth.
All right,
Mom. So long.
So long. Bob, do you remember the famous broadcast we did from the Red Sox dugout last summer?
That was wonderful. I believe you handled that. I turned things over to you at the Red Sox park. That was on a historic day, as I remember.
Then we also did the final game at the Yankee Stadium when the Red Sox lost out in that last game of the Yankees.
We spoke to you direct from the dugout right after that game, and we heard on-the-spot interviews with several of the...
I remember going up to Mr. McCarty and saying, Joe, and he said...
Then,
All you are 1-2 hours old. I am buzzy.
And we had some auspicious commercials last year. Excuse the expression.
Some what kind of commercials?
Well, some big ones.
I warned you about that word.
Remember, we were sponsored by U.S. Steel for quite a long while.
That's right. That was awful nice to those folks.
It's nice working for them.
We just didn't sell steel, friends. I don't know why you think this program could sell steel.
We offered the handy burglary kit for 3 or 4 weeks after that.
Remember that one, friends, when we sold you suction shoes for walking up sides of buildings?
Also, together with the first order, you'd receive the Bob and Ray How to Enter the Profitable Field of Burglary for Fun and Profit.
Remember, we also told you of 4 employees of First National Bank who would sing.
And together with floor plans of several national banks throughout the country.
Well, that was a big seller and went over great in America.
Do you remember how you got that? You simply... I wrote for it, and it came to you COD when the postman arrived. You took $2.98 from him. That started you on your career.
Remember that? Well, they're all gone, so don't be writing for any more, friends. Please don't, because we're all out of them.
Mary, you had a great conspicuous first in the year 1949.
Well, my first record came on the market, Bob.
Mm-hmm.
And it went over just like a lead balloon.
I know, I remember that one. That teamed up Mule Train and one of Nick Kenny's great songs. How about giving us half a chorus of Nick Kenny's song, huh?
I don't remember it.
Well, hum it.
I'd like to be a cow in Switzerland, where the skies are always blue, where the milkmaids yodel all the day to their sweethearts miles and miles away.
Then in September, we introduced a couple... Well, that was enough. These are just reprises,
yes,
you know.
Certainly, I'm sorry.
Ray and I introduced...
Ray, I'll just sing it over in the...
Well, you go over in the corner and sing, because Ray and I introduced a song.
Quiet, Mary. Take your hands out of the marshmallow.
You remember the one we did, Kay Toomey's song? Do you remember what that was?
Kay Toomey's song?
Don't you remember that song she wrote and we harmonized?
The music goes round and round?
No, this was the new one.
Spanish? No.
Ray,
that was Higgy Kamuko wrote that one.
I know what it was. Let's harmonize. You remember that one?
Oh, yeah.
We did a wonderful job on that.
Too bad we don't have the words. We could do it again.
We never did.
I tell you what, while we look around for the words, we can, as a matter of fact, they're in Bill Green's private locker, which is conveniently located, friends, for television.
I wish you wouldn't leave sandwiches in there so long, Bill. With the music,
Bill keeps a small drugstore in there, too. Are you insisting on inhisting, Bill? Do you have any inhiston in there?
He has some eyewash there.
That poses a question. Where are they now?
I don't know.
Well,
they haven't been with us for quite... We do have Chesterfields. Would you like to...
Who's our guest Chesterfield star today? Before we play it, you remember, friends, about several features that we told you about Chesterfield that you never talk about, that the people don't know about, probably, that you can take the paper off of Chesterfield. There's a little strip of glue on it. You wet it, and you can hold up little locks of hair.
If you put more glue on the paper.
Yeah. Of course, you can save the tobacco to put in your pipe. That's another one of those many things that you can do. No, that isn't the song.
No, that's not the one, Bill. We never did learn that one.
Oh, this is called Gee, It's Tough to Be a Skunk.
This one we really made popular this past year, though.
Why don't they play it?
Chesterfield satisfy women than men. Chesterfield over and over again. Milder, much milder, all smokers agree. Always by GC.
Now let's introduce young Dr. Brent.
Hi, folks.
7 years old. This year marked a big thing in Dr. Brent's life because he performed one of his most dangerous operations.
I remember that very well. I took out my own brain.
I remember that. We were there in the operating room with you. We heard you say to your nurse,
hand me the scalpel, please, nurse.
Okay, Doc.
Wait a minute. Hold it. Stop.
We have a small
class. Radio Industry send you over as a nurse?
They did, yes.
I hear that voice again.
Okay, Doc.
I don't know, something about a nurse that talks like that.
They said something about you got a small budget up here.
I know we've got a small budget, but...
And I could be used in the Western scenes, too.
Can you also play a gangster part?
Anything you want.
Yeah. Okay, well, then we can use you, maybe. All right, so the nurse sounds like that. That's it, organ music.
Here's your scalpel, Doc. By the way, here's your scalp, too.
Thanks.
What do you think's the matter with him?
Take his pulse, will you?
Where do you want me to take it?
On his arm.
Oh,
wait a minute here.
See.
Hand me up a blotter there, will you?
Well,
okay.
I like that red gown you're wearing, Doc.
It was white when I came in.
let's see now. I wonder if he's getting enough oxygen here.
I don't know. Slap him in the face. See if he hears
yeah.
you.
Hey, ow! Wake up there.
Better give him a little more sturdy.
Yeah, he needs a little more, I guess.
Wait a minute.
Uh-oh. I think he stopped breathing, Doc.
Wait a minute. Let's pull up this sheet. Up over his head.
Oh.
Now, let's get out of here.
Let's get out of here.
Let's ride. Come on. For his second offering, our organist, Mr. Wilson, will play...
Can't you hear me calling Caroline?
Caroline.
You hear me calling, Caroline?
I want some volunteers to go with me to the pass. There's been some dirty work.
What kind of dirty work?
Laundry.
1949 as well.
As well as...
The year when we touched serious situations like that involving the return of Little Skipper to Linda and David's lives.
Next, Linda Lovely.
Written for radio by A. Carrington Lump and starring Marcia Van Allshot as Linda, Sherman L. Sturdley as David. Let's turn back the clock to a day late in summer, the small house in Riversmouth. The clock is striking 3, and David and Linda have just come in from the garden where they have had a mid-afternoon picnic.
David, darling, you
yes,
have
a... I heard you call me, so I came.
David, would you like cocoa?
Hey. I believe I'll have a cup, yes.
All right, my darling.
And...
Oh, David, there's a rose in your mouth.
I know that.
Oh.
Pass me one of those...
Oh, my
peanut
darling.
Butter sandwiches.
David, you're so strong.
Excuse me, Linda, your dress is on fire.
Oh. Well.
I'll help you put it up. There.
Thank you, David. You're so strong. Strong, my darling.
Awfully warm for July, wouldn't you say?
Yes, David.
Have you heard from Lawyer Tucker?
He called this morning. He said Skipper will be coming home soon.
Little Skipper but coming David, back home.
David, I can't go on.
That went on for 3 weeks, and we didn't require any lines or anything. Then in September, a new character entered Linda and David's lives.
Miserable life.
Uncle Eugene came upon the scene.
Uncle Eugene?
It was just at the time when Linda had received a sterling silver imitation ivory love brooch in the shape of a piston ring.
Say, Linda, that's a mighty beautiful sterling silver ivory type piston ring love brooch you're wearing there.
It was sent to me by an anonymous
Who
sender.
Who sent it to you?
An anonymous sender.
Why, that is mighty beautiful there on the back of your neck.
Thank you.
I'll bet all of your friends would like to receive one exactly like it, too.
Oh, I don't suppose they could, because I have the only one in the world.
It's...
This little handy locket here.
That's a locket,
Excuse me a minute. Do you see this handy locket here?
Yes.
See what I can keep in it? Stockings.
Say, that's a mighty big locket, isn't it?
Yes.
I used to have a locket like that in high school. Kept my books in it.
Oh, Uncle Eugene, you're so strong. Look how your thumb's there.
Linda, it would be so wonderful if all of your friends could receive one of these genuine...
Wouldn't it be wonderful if the sponsor could make his way clear?
I should imagine they'd be much too expensive, Aunt Linda, to send to all of your many friends who would send a box top and 10 cents cover handling and mailing.
I have a feeling that the announcer at the end of the program will have something special to say about this brooch.
Oh, if only he would.
Oh, it's too much to expect.
Too much to expect, I suppose.
Is that telephone ringing?
No, it isn't.
Then that collar's too tight on my neck.
Well, we listened a little bit later and heard the announcer make that wonderful announcement.
Yes, ladies, get in on this great thing. Be the first one in your neighborhood with a genuine imitation sterling ivory brooch.
Be a big wheel in your gang.
Remember, you catch it at the back of the neck with a Tootsie Roll.
What else do we have in 19...
Be the first member in your crowd to wear this exclusive Linda Lovely brooch.
Be a pillow in your society.
Pillar
in your society. What other things do we have in 1949?
Well, we were fired once and then rehired.
Luckily, it was on a Saturday and we were back to work Monday.
They had forgotten about it. Nobody but we won't reenact those horrible scenes, certainly.
No, we
should avoid them. I think we should turn to Ken and Bill, the 385th Field Artillery Orchestra.
That's right. The song that received the most requests during the past year for Ken and Bill to play.
Send Them Home, it's called.
With you by Ken and Bill.
Say, Bob, did you happen to see the schedule this morning where it made mention of the fact that the Boston Traveler, starting this coming Wednesday, would have...
Boston, wait a minute, Ray. I've heard that name somewhere before.
Boston Traveler, newspaper.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Well, now, starting Wednesday, the 4th of January, they're going to have the adventures of, I think, Skip Along Garibaldi. Is that right?
I think that's his name, or Jump Along Muldoon or something.
Well, I don't know. So I went out and I found this transcription, and I thought we could play it and
tell the whole story.
Yeah, remind everyone about it.
Okay.
So, and I picked out two good men to go to work on this transcription.
Well, I know, being in the talent business as you have been so long.
You see, I have my finger on it all the time.
Sure.
I have my finger on the pulse of the nation.
Uh-huh.
I remember one time when I was handling Dave Rubinoff and his violin.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, Bob. There goes that ornery vomit now.
Not me, Ray. I ain't going after him. I'm staying right here.
You mean?
Yeah, I'm yeller.
Come to think of it, so am I. Here, let's hold up here.
Right. Hold up there, old tangle.
Hold up there, boss. Hold up. Oh, we ain't got nothing to worry about. Why, look who's here. Hop along.
Hi, partners. This is your friend Hopalong Cassidy. I've got some good news for you. Starting Wednesday, January 4th, I'm going to be with you every day in the comic pages of your favorite newspaper.
And the favorite newspaper hereabouts is the Boston Traveler.
If you enjoy my television pictures and my radio show, I'm sure you'll like the new Hopalong Cassidy comic strip. It will be full of fast, hard-riding action and adventure and plenty of thrills. Topper's in it, too. And we tango with some pretty tough hombres right from the start. I hope you enjoy it.
stage. Wait for me, Bob. I want to reserve my Boston Traveler for next Wednesday, too. Won't catch me missing a single episode of Hop Along Cassidy.
You did. You did pick two good men for that.
You know why I won't miss one?
Why?
I'd be fired if I did. But anyway, I think that should be real great, Hop Along Cassidy. He's always been a big favorite of mine.
Ray, I happen to have seen a few of the advance releases from this mighty interesting Western adventure strip.
You did, Tex? What do you think about it?
I think it's here to stay, and I want to go on record as saying that.
Well, anyway, I think Bill Boyd will go to work on his third million now.
Well, I think Bill will get along with three squares a day, and after all, that's what counts.
You bet. It's the biggest thing in life. Down there by the old chuck wagon?
You said it. Under that western moon on the prairie.
Airing the old sneakers. Well, those were the days. Now, why don't we go out west for a while, or do you think we ought to do our...
We had an interesting discovery one time this past year when we roamed to the far-off Orient, discovered a program very similar to one that we were used to listening to around here. Remember that one?
Oh, I remember now. The Yangtze River Incorporated presents Mr. Lee and his unoriginal Bad Will Hour.
Thank you, Mr. Wong. First problem, please.
My problem is this, Mr. Lee.
Don't mention any proper name or places, please.
Yes. I've been a pirate on the Yellow River.
Don't mention a proper name, place.
I've been a pirate on this here river.
Let me see if I have your story right to this point. You say you've been a pirate.
Yes, and I met this here woman in Hong Kong.
I see,
Excuse
me, you have a bit of chasu din on lapel there.
What?
A chasu din on lapel. Now, continue with a problem, please.
This here woman, she shanghaied me.
Oh, I see. This woman shanghaied you, huh?
Yeah. To make a long story short, Mr. Lee...
That's all we want here, yeah.
I've come for your advice. I mean, I don't know what to do. I didn't tell you I shot her. I didn't tell you that part.
Let me ask you a couple questions.
Yeah.
You have told anybody about this?
What, you think you're crazy? No, the cops would be looking for me then.
My advice to you is to get out of town quick.
I see. Any particular town?
I don't want to mention any particular town. Maybe you have relatives you can go live with. Do you have sisters?
Yeah, I got three sisters. Patty, Maxine, and Levine.
I will suggest you go live with them. Yeah. Until this whole thing blow over.
I don't know. They'd be glad to see me, you know. I mean, they don't like me, I don't think, you know.
You understand I cannot give you legal advice on program, though no tongue will be after me.
I see.
However, if you stay and see me in my pagoda after program, I give you a little more advice.
Incidentally, friends, if you'd like to buy a Tong War Bond, simply send along $10 to Tong War Bonds, care of this station.
Then we went out west several times last year. We got into hot water two or three times.
And
we didn't have any soap with us, but didn't help matters.
You remember the time we made the movie short?
Yes, that
was about
a short
two or three reels short.
Yeah.
It only had one reel, and both of us were hung in that first reel, and everyone was dissatisfied when they went to our opening night at Grauman's Chinese Theater. We had fresh cement there, and everyone got stuck in the lobby, don't
They're
you know?
They're still standing there. We bring them food all
I'm
the
reminded
time.
Of the great poet Browning, who once said... Any more commercials?
No, we've run through the commercials.
Well, look, here's another thing. Here's a song written by Joe Candulo, Bob.
Oh, yes, sure.
Jack Joyce, and Ken and Will, Ken and Bill played it earlier. So why don't we sing it? I Want to Go Home with You.
Well, you sing it. I don't really know.
All right. I don't know it very well myself. So don't laugh at me, friends. Maybe someday you'll have to sing.
This was the big new voice of 1949.
Incidentally, don't be you sitting around radios at home. Don't be giggling at me, you know? I'm very tender, you know? Okay. Aren't you going to play? I want to go home with you. I want to go home with you. I want to meet the family. I'm sure that they'll approve of me. I want to go home with you. And nobody else will do. Kissing goodnight at your front door makes me love you more and more.
You folks ain't giggling now. You never will be.
This phone ring, Bob.
Yes, it did.
Hello?
It was a lucky thing.
Okay, lady. Yes. Yeah, I know. I've never had no train or nothing like that, no. Yeah. Thank you.
Hang up in the face.
Thank you very much, madam.
She has no talent when she hears it.
I want to go home with you. Thank you and good night.
There you have the,
you like
big,
that one?
The big new voice of last year.
So get your votes in. Remember, the honest city is Superior, Wisconsin. And
number out there is 717-223-4489.
Here, I'll call him right Jay. Now, as a matter of fact. Now, this is how you call it.
You getting it? You dialing?
Yeah, I'm getting it now.
Quite a long number.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. It's longer than we have here in Boston.
Sure is. The biggest city out
there.
Yeah. There she is. Hey. Hello?
Hello, is this the Honest City?
Right-o.
Is this the right number?
I believe it is, sir. 717-724-223-44968.
No, no, that's the wrong number. I'm sorry.
Oh,
I better hang up.
Sorry.
Here, I'll dial him again.
All right.
I'll get him this time.
Hello?
Hello?
You got the right number this time.
Yes, I want to vote for Ray Goulding.
Okay,
he's great.
Okay, I'll put your vote down here on our master tabulator.
Thank you very much, sir, for calling.
And master tabulator is standing right beside me. I'd like to have him say a few words.
Thanks very much, Pop.
How old are you?
That's awful good to be here with you.
Well, thanks to have you, master.
Yeah, certainly.
Bill Green,
But now, the makers of Snickers presents Dr. O.K., the Sentimental Banker. So we're taking out of the stage of Lowe's Poli Theater and Last Chance Saskatchewan. Dr. O.K., the Sentimental Banker.
Thank you, Mr. Sturdley. Before we get to our questions and contestants for today, let me introduce my assistants here at Lowe's Poli Theater, Last Chance Saskatchewan. In the orchestra to my right, Ed Sturdley.
Thank you, Doctor.
In the center orchestra, Ed Sturdley.
Thank you, Doctor.
In the orchestra to my left, downstairs, Ed Sturdley.
I'm not going too fast for you, Doctor,
yes,
am I?
Yes, you are. Down in the balcony upstairs, Ed Sturdley. And now to our first contestant,
you,
Ed Sturdley, in the orchestra downstairs. Excuse me, in the balcony upstairs. Hurry along now, please. We don't have too much time.
I have a gentleman, Doctor.
All right, for that gentleman, Doctor, here's our famous American question. I can give you three clues. If you answer after the first, your prize will be a portable wall safe. If you answer after the second, a genuine live chameleon from the island of Madagascar. But if it takes you all three clues, your prize will be an electric welding kit. Is that clear, sir?
Yes, sir.
Number one clue, I was born.
Ah, Ted Williams, Margaret O'Brien, and William Pendick.
Those are good guesses, sir, but they're not correct. Let's wait for your second clue.
Flicker.
No,
Flicker.
I'm sorry. I invented
Flinders.
The steamboat. Oh. Wait for your clues. I invented the steamboat, the electric typewriter. I hung by my thumbs from the Empire State Building for 2 hours and 45 minutes before dropping off. Who am I?
Oh, Grant Volney.
Oh, you're right as far as you've gone, sir. You'll have to complete his name.
Grant
Volney what, sir?
Grant Volney LeBeuf.
No,
Grant Volney McGee.
No, I'm...
Grant Volney,
Oh, I'm awfully sorry. Your time is up, sir. I think you'd find his full name to be Grant Volney Jr. But
oh,
a box of Snickers
to
that. What size Snickers do you wear, sir?
8½.
And your name and address, please.
John Kieran, New York 20, New York.
Gee, boy, that about winds things up, doesn't it?
Yeah, it should before the cops arrive.
The last program and the last series and the last year and the wrong pod, probably a little late, so...
Hey, look, everybody, be real careful this weekend, will you? And be around Monday so that you can listen to us if for no other reason. We'll try to be here. In fact, we will.
Well, we expect to be.
Ken Wilson played
all
the organ.
Preparations to be
yeah.
Here.
Bill Green played the piano. Jimmy Sullivan was our grand...
You were grand, Jim.
Matinee with Bob and Ray is heard every day, Monday through Saturday at 1 o'clock. Remember, if you get work, write, and hang by your thumbs. Happy New Year, everybody.
WHDH in the good old city of... Isn't it? Is it still here? What is it? What happened?
Wait a minute, stop. Wait,
yeah, stop the music.
Wait a minute, we have to find out what goes on the air here. What goes on the air here, Bob?
Regent Cigarettes.
Regent Cigarettes? What do you know about that? You mean...
Yes, this can mean war.
Here, hand me the phone. Hello, Washington? George?
Correction, please. Regents do not cost extra.
Correction, please. Regents do not cost extra.
King-size Regent cigarettes are oval-shaped for 10% cooler smoking. Yet Regents cost not 1 cent extra.
Luxury smoke.
Regular price. Regent cigarettes.
First news first, here is the 1:30 edition of the Herald Traveler News. The United States and the other four members of the Inter-American Peace Committee have joined in censuring the Dominican Republic. The committee has sharply criticized the Dominican government for giving President Trujillo the power to declare...
That was Matinee with Bob and Ray from December 31st, 1949. Well, that's it for this episode of Airchecks. We will have more New Year's Day specials tomorrow, so stay tuned for episode 52. Beginning January 6th, we will be uploading only 1 3-hour podcast of Airchecks on a weekly basis. See you at the same time and same channel.